You're strapped in to a live radio broadcast on Pure Rock Radio.
Just about everyone and their dog has a website or uses a domain name like yourname.com. Thanks to our partnership with GoDaddy, the leader in hosting and domain name registration, we can offer all our listeners big savings on everything GoDaddy offers. Go to purerockradio.net/GoDaddy for a full list of coupon codes to save on hosting your website, registering your domain name, and much more. You can even switch to GoDaddy anytime to start saving, and our coupon codes will never expire. Every time you use one of our coupon codes, it benefits you, Pure Rock Radio, and all the shows we carry. So thanks for visiting purerockradio.net/GoDaddy today. Try coupon code POD167 to save 10% off your GoDaddy purchases today.
Welcome to the used bin. All music, all the time. What are you listening to? Used Bin Radio.
Good evening, everybody. What is happening to you? To the back in the village. Good evening, Bruce. Thank you for bringing us in. We appreciate it. How are you, everybody? Welcome to Used Bin Radio. It is Tuesday night. We are live. And happy to be with you tonight. So things are a little different. As you know, if any of you were paying attention last week, if you guys did your homework, check this out on Facebook and Twitter. We let you know that, well, there is no Joe Mama tonight. I am Brad, but there is no Joe. Where is Joe? Well, the answer is coming soon. So let me tell you what we got going on before we even do that. First of all, in studio with me, hanging out with me for the full 3 hours tonight, Mr. Stephen Humphreys. How are you, pal?
Hey, Brad. How are you doing?
I am well.
I'm ready to rock. Are you ready to rock?
I'm always ready to rock.
All right. I'm ready to roll, too.
Good. Well, I'm glad that you're with us tonight. I appreciate you coming down and hanging out. The Metal Warrior Princess Rachel should be here any moment. She will be barging in, smelling pretty as usual. And so let me tell you what we got going on. Phone lines are open, 888-405-7440. That is a phone number. Give us a call if you got anything you want to talk about, any tunes you've been listening to, shows you've been to. I don't know, anything else you just want to talk about, it's fine with us.
Yeah, but please, no heavy breathers.
You know, why?
We don't want that kind of thing.
Does that make you uncomfortable?
Depends.
What if I went...
I'm out of here, man. It's been fun.
Oh, come on. It's beautiful. That's manly stuff right there, pal.
That's the problem. It's manly.
All right. Well, there you go. So, no heavy breathers. But you can also get us on the email if you want to, which is usedbinradio@usedbin.com. So, the phone number, 888-405-7440. The email, usedbinradio@usedbin.com. Go ahead and hit that. Let's see if we actually got a phone call. Let's see if we can make this work. All right, let's see if we can make this work. Who's in the used bin? How are you?
William McDaniel.
Hey, buddy. How are you, William? What's up, buddy?
Not much. What's up with you guys tonight?
Well, no Joe Mama tonight. It's all me, pal. Me and Stephen Humphreys. Say hello to Stephen.
He's off.
Hey, how you doing?
Hello, Stephen. How are you?
Yeah, good, man.
So what's going on, William? What do you got for us tonight, pal?
Well, it's been busy the last little while. I just got accepted to college for next year, so I know what I'm doing for that.
Good job. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Where are you going?
And I'm going to Oakville, which is about half hour, 40 minutes outside of Toronto for technical production, like to do sound.
Oh, very good.
I thought I detected a Canadian accent there. As soon as I said a boat...
Yes, William, just so you know, Stephen, William is probably our youngest listener. Senior in high school, obviously, and a massive Prague fan, and a bit of a standout in his school because he's such a Prague fan. Isn't that right?
A man of great taste. It's fantastic. Tell us what you've been listening to.
Yes. Well, Last week I went on a trip to Quebec, so I got some new CDs to listen to. I've been listening to the Triple Dream Theater Score CD.
Very good. How do you like
which
that?
Which is amazing.
Yeah.
Six Degrees Live and Octavarium and Metropolis, that was worth the $35 right there, in my opinion.
Absolutely. Good job, man. Well, that's impressive because I know you're still, you're only what, probably a couple months into Six Degrees, am I right? Just the studio version.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, that live version with the orchestra is ridiculous.
Yeah, it's really good, and if you guys still have it in the junk drawer, I recommend the listeners to phone in and try and get it because that's a great deal getting it for free.
I would agree. Well, we're going to do a little overrated, underrated later on. And if we get actual, unless you've got one, if you want to talk a little overrated, underrated, but if someone's got a good one, something that maybe stumps us a little bit, we'll throw something at you in the junk drawer. Although, I have to be honest with you, I have no clue what's in the junk drawer. Joe has the key to the junk drawer, and I'm not old enough or qualified enough to be able to look in there, so... Once he's back, we'll get somebody something.
You don't have
something.
To write forms, fine.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I'm a bit of a mess, William. You just should know that right off the bat. Therefore, Joe is Joe's the brains of the operation. I'm just happy to be here.
Brad is the beauty of the operation.
Right.
What's that? What'd you say, William?
I said I'm a bit of a mess, too, so that's all right.
That's why we're such good pals.
Oh, this is a bit of Coverdale Page you got playing here. Turn us up a bit, Joe. Brad, rather.
I'm Brad.
Sorry.
Joe's not here.
So, yeah.
Do you miss Joe, Stephen?
Joe, I miss you so much, buddy.
You better say no.
I miss you so much, buddy. Are you listening?
You're supposed to say no. I'm glad that Brad's here.
I'm so glad Brad's here.
Thank you. What else, William? What else you been listening to, pal?
Well, I got also on that trip, I got the double disc Marillion Thieving Magpie.
Very good.
Right. As well as Misplaced Childhood. Mm-hmm. And I've been listening to a little bit of The Suffering Joy from Magic Pie.
How great is that record?
As well as... It's really good, and I really like their first one, too.
Motions of Desire.
Yeah.
I'm a fan myself, actually. I'm considering tonight playing one of the longer tracks off that first record, so I don't know. I'm trying to figure it out, but I love that album. Everything about it I love.
Well, when you guys were having them on and you played that one song, I got to go and get this somewhere right now.
Good. Well, that's great.
I was just hooked from first listen, and it was great.
Now, did you have to import that from Norway, or was it readily available in your nearby record store?
It was in iTunes, I believe, is where I ended up getting it.
You know what? I'm glad you got it, because I know that once we did that interview and I couldn't find that thing anywhere. And I think they had some trouble getting it into, at least here in the U.S. anyway, getting it into some of the online stores and even some of the regular record outlets. It was very tough to find. I think it took them a couple weeks, but I'm glad to know it's available.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it was iTunes. It was either iTunes or one of those other music stores online right. that I ended up getting it from, because Walmart doesn't have that, and that's really the only
well, because
store around me.
Walmart's not smart enough. But you can't blame them for that.
No, I can't blame them for that, really.
That's right. Could you find Dream Theater in Walmart?
I don't think I've seen Dream Theater. I've seen the new Iron Maiden album.
Oh, okay. Well, that's good.
Walmart,
that's good.
No Dream Theater.
Well, they're halfway smart, though. They're almost there.
Yes.
Cool, man. So you've been listening to a lot of tunes.
A little bit more of a book.
Right.
Yeah, I've been busy.
Very good.
Like I said, I was on that trip last week, so I had had 15-hour bus ride both ways to listen to music, so.
Dude, 15 hours to Quebec from where you live, is that right?
Yeah, around 15 hours on the bus.
Wow.
Wow.
Did you didn't just go there for music, did you?
No.
Oh, okay.
No, it was a grade 12 trip.
Got it. All right, well, I'm glad you made the required stops at the record store. So, let me tell you something.
Well, yes, I got it.
Go ahead.
I got a 2112 sweater on sale, too, so that was good.
God bless you, my friend.
Now, did you get that at Walmart?
No. No.
I mean, come on. Walmart and
HMV.
You got to think Walmart in Canada has 2112, you know, T-shirts by the dozen, right?
That's outstanding.
I did see a Rush T-shirt in Walmart, though.
Yeah, I think so. You know, I mean, aren't those guys basically your national heroes? Isn't 2112 basically the second Canadian anthem?
Well, it's my second Canadian anthem, but not so much, really, around here anyways.
Well,
is unfortunate.
So, tell me, since you're a Canadian, and I don't watch a whole lot of ice hockey, but I hear that the ice hockey theme is really the sort of second Canadian anthem, and Neil Peart recently did a version of that for the NHL.
Hockey Night in Canada theme.
Yeah, what do you think of that?
I think it was really good. It was basically like the original version had like horns and everything, and basically my take was it was the original version with a drum solo in it. But I really liked it, and actually they released it for Rock Band, so I downloaded that, and I still can't play it because it's just...
God, it's Neil Peart. No one, don't feel too badly, dude. Very few people can play Neil Peart, so...
Right.
Just, you know, give it 20 years of practice, you know, maybe you'll get it down.
There you go. All right, William, what else you got going on, pal?
Well, that's pretty much it. I had a question for Stephen, actually.
Uh-oh.
Okay, go ahead.
My sex life is off limits, by the way, so just so you know, but go ahead.
Okay, talk to you later, guys. No. it said on, when I was reading the Used Bin front page here, that Stephen was a music journalist, and I was just wondering what was the most interesting thing that you've ever had to cover?
Interesting thing I've ever had to cover?
Ooh.
Well, I get to cover all sorts of things. But I remember going to my first Ozfest back in, was that 2000, 1999, thereabouts? That was a pretty interesting one. There was Marilyn Manson walking around the stage on stilts.
Great show.
And Slipknot with their drummer, Joey Jordison. I think they're crap, but the drummer was great fun to watch. You know, he's on a hydraulic lift.
They're totally entertaining, though, live.
Oh, yeah.
I'm not a Slipknot fan either, but live, they're very entertaining to watch.
Oh, yeah, there's a lot to watch. You know, those guys are running around on stage in their masks. And the drummer's on this hydraulic riser that's like a roller coaster. He's
right.
Playing upside down at one point.
Yeah.
That was pretty wild. And that was actually the first time I got to see Sabbath. That was great.
Yeah. Did you cover them for a magazine or?
I was working at that time. I was working for the Christian Science Monitor newspaper, and they dispatched me to do a story for that. That's pretty cool.
That's great. The Christian Science Monitor doing stories on Ozfest on Manson and Slipknot. That's just
fantastic.
At any point in that article, did you mention the words Antichrist Superstar?
I did not. You know, that just
would that get edited out?
Huge regrets. Why not put that in there?
Would they let you write about that?
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah, no problem.
Beauty.
But
that's great.
So that you know, I've done a lot of really interesting things, but you stopped me there. Now you've got me trying to think back and stuff that I've covered. All sorts of good stuff. But anyway, I'd have to think a bit more about that.
All right, William. Good stuff, man. Thank you so much for the call. Glad you got accepted into college. That's good news.
Thank you. And yes. I just wanted, just before I get off the line, another thing we listened to was the Big Four DVD.
Oh, how is that?
And it was really good, but Lars needs to lose the double bass. He just looks like a complete and total tool behind that drum kit.
Yeah, well, you know, I hesitate to say it, but I think it's the only way that guy knows how to keep time. He's the only drummer in that genre. Although I guess he's gotten a little bit better, but that guy, he couldn't keep time to save his life. That's for sure. I mean, it's pretty bad.
Get a half decent double pedal.
Uh-huh.
I mean, he's got two bass drums, and then he's got these two tiny rack toms. It's not like he even has like a full complement of rack toms that he needs that extra
Right.
That extra drum to mount it to, just get rid of that single kick.
That's totally true.
Whatever you want.
Yeah, I think you're absolutely right. I think it's funny, which I'm going to talk about here in a second, but I finally got to the Lemmy movie, the Lemmy documentary. And in there's a bit where, you know, where he comes, where Lemmy goes on stage with Metallica, and Lars is just such a tool. I mean, he really is just a tool. So I couldn't agree with you more. So there you go.
And, you know, the drums on some of those Metallica albums is just terrible, isn't it? I mean, it's just a horrible drum sound.
It's thin.
It's very thin.
His snare is very tin canny. Mm-hmm. It's very tinny. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. Totally agree. What were you going to say, William?
And in the past, he must have had a really bad monitor man because he must have been leaning really forward, and now his neck sticks out like crazy too.
Well, that's because he needs attention. That's what it is.
Yeah. Look at me.
That's right.
That was another thing. With that Big Four DVD and had the documentary on when they were all getting together to play Am I Evil, and everybody had to go talk to Lars to make sure. Ugh. Is this going to be all right, Lars? Is this going to be... come on.
All right, William. Thanks, man. Glad that you called. Glad you got into college. And well, I hope we hear from you soon. I know it's late over there, so I'm glad you found some time to call in.
Yeah, I figured I probably won't get a chance for the next couple weeks, so I figured I'd call in tonight and probably listen to a little bit more of the bin.
Good.
And then get ready for school in the morning.
Cool, man. Talk to you soon. Thanks, William.
Take care.
Talk to you later.
Bye.
Bye.
Well, we've just been joined in the studio by Rachel.
Doesn't it smell
Metal
good?
Metal Warrior Princess. Oh, it smells
Rachel,
so good.
Do you need headphones? You don't have yours? Okay, see if we can... look at that. Steven came prepared tonight, so he's got the extra set. Very nice.
Rachel, my Bose noise canceling headphones.
There you go. All right, in the meantime, let me give you a quick rundown as to what we're going to be doing tonight. I mentioned earlier, we're going to do a little overrated, underrated. So that is, for anybody that wants to call in, give us your overrated, underrated. I will set the ground rules if you have not played this game with us before, but it's one of my favorites. Overrated, underrated. So you're going to bring up an artist, a band, a musician, doesn't matter who, and you are going to... Do you need a thing? Oh, okay, you're going to have to hang on a second, then I'll find you one. And you are going to bring up a band, an artist... Musician, doesn't matter, solo, doesn't make a difference. And we will discuss if they are overrated, underrated, or right on the money. Now, the criteria for this is simple, and I'll give you an example. And the example is Radiohead for me. Radiohead, they are the critic's darling. Everybody loves Radiohead. They think they're the greatest. Those guys can't do anything wrong. If those guys just farted for 45 minutes, it would be maybe the finest album on the planet Earth, and they would headline every single festival known to man. Okay? According to that, are they overrated or underrated? Steven, go.
Radiohead is brilliant. Absolutely.
Right on the money?
Oh, they're great. I mean, they really are a truly progressive band. And, you know, Tom York is such a beautiful, beautiful vocalist. I mean, what an expressive and an amazing voice. And they're just very unusual, you know, with their blend of rock and ambient music. And the way that they've sort of brought a lot of underground music into the mainstream and blended it together, I think they're very special and an incredible live band. So yeah. absolutely, probably even underrated.
That's awful.
You don't even like OK Computer?
Love OK, right? And love the Benz.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what about...
But even with those two records, as good as those records are, totally overrated. Yeah, they're totally overrated. I mean, I think the band's good.
What about In Rainbows? Did you ever hear that record?
Yeah, we'll play a track from that tonight.
All right.
Yeah, or maybe not, depending. I don't know, it's good. That's a good record. That's a little closer back to form. But, you know, we talked about this the other week. It's just problem with Radiohead is pops and clicks. Totally overrated. Like, this is a band that can't seem to do anything wrong in every critic's eyes. I can't remember finding a review of a Radiohead record that was even close to being, you know, like, well... You know, this is an average record. This just isn't quite up to par. Every record is God's gift to music. I mean, seriously. When I read that, the two words come to mind. Blow and me. Seriously. I mean, it's ridiculous. Tom York is fine. He's a wonderful man. God bless him. But Jesus Christ, really? I mean, really?
I think they're brilliant. Let's see who got on the line. We've got the song calling in.
All right, let's see what we got. Hi, who's in the Usbin?
Hey, what's going on?
Who's this?
This is Thomas from Kansas City.
Hey, Jonathan, what's up, man? How you doing?
Oh, no, Tony from Kansas City.
That's what I said, Tony. I guess I just didn't say it right. What's up, man?
Hey, nothing, man. I just want to let you know what I've been listening to lately.
Do it.
Stevie Wonder, Hotter Than July.
Nice. Very good.
I don't know why I'm drawn to it. Well, because it's a great record. But I was just doing some Wikipedia look, and you know the old like, what came first, the chicken or the egg? I was wondering which came first, Hotter Than July or Bo Derek and 10.
What? And what'd you come up with?
Bo Derek. That movie came out like 11 months prior.
Is that right?
Yeah, I didn't know that. But, you know, I mean, that is a great album. It came right after Songs in the Key of Life, you know. And that's like, you know, Presence after Physical Graffiti, you know. How do you top an awesome double record like that? So, anyway.
Isn't it a little bit unseasonable to be listening to Hotter in July in March?
Especially in Kansas City.
Yeah.
Exactly.
That's funny. Dude, how hot, just really quick, how hot was Bo Derek in 10? I mean, come on. Dude.
She didn't, now that, talk about overrated, huh?
You think she's overrated, Bo Derek?
Back then, yeah. I mean, come on.
Did you see Tommy Boy? Do you remember that movie, Tommy Boy?
No, I didn't see it.
Dude, you have to see Tommy Boy with Chris Farley. It's the funniest movie you've ever seen, right? Chris Farley, Rob Lowe. Yeah, and Bo Derek plays the mother in that movie. And she's got to be 177 years old. And I think it was right before her 178th birthday, actually. And, dude, she's still hot.
Oh, she's smoking. Right? You know, she's like one of those women like Dana Delaney who, you know, she must be well into her 50s and still, wow.
Yeah.
She'll turn your head.
Yeah, well done, Bo Derek. I'm very upset with this, Tony. This is a conversation just took a wrong turn.
Well, I gotta admit, I do like Linda Evans a lot better. That's just my opinion. That's just me, though.
Wow.
Linda Evans, wow.
You just went Linda Evans on us, huh?
Yeah, well, I don't know. I don't know why. That's why I love your show so much. Come on. We can talk about anything. You guys are incredible.
Thank you very much, man. I appreciate it. So, well, so what else you been listening to besides Stevie Wonder?
There's a band from Tunisia called My Rap. Tell the Metal Princess to look them up. They're spelled MYRATH. My Rap. They incorporate a lot of like Arabic music into their metal. They're very progressive. I love them. They were a pleasant surprise to me. So
interesting.
How'd
you find those guys?
Through another internet radio show. You know, there was a show that actually they just had their last broadcast. They were called the Metal Lessons Radio.
Oh, okay. Oh, I've heard of Metal. Metal Lessons was on PureRockRadio.net, actually.
Exactly. Yeah. Last night was their last show.
Oh, okay.
So that's how I discovered them.
What's the name of the band again?
My Rap.
My Rap.
My Rap. MYRATH.
So let me ask you this. Have you checked out a band called Orphaned Land from Israel?
Yes, I have. And that was the other group I was going to tell you I've been listening to as well. They are phenomenal. They're great. They recite like these old Jewish like passages in their music.
Mm-hmm.
They're awesome.
Yeah, yes. they are good.
And they... For the listeners out there, if you haven't come across Orphaned Land, they're a metal band from Israel, and they sort of incorporate metal with some Middle Eastern textures and that sort of that music indigenous to that region.
Right.
And Stephen Wilson of Porcupine Tree is a big fan. He has performed with them on stage, and I think he mixed their last record, in fact.
Huh. I can tell you this. You know what's funny is that I... Orphanland's come up on this show quite a bunch, actually. And I don't know if it's... maybe it's just me, but are they maybe sort of leading that charge of the Middle Eastern metal? Am I right about that, or am I wrong?
I think so. And the thing is, oddly enough, I came across an article that said that they're pretty big in Iran, of all places. So here's this.
That's got to be tough to make happen.
You know, I mean, that's probably real underground stuff in Iran. You can probably get stoned for listening to that stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
And not to go out, stoned in the Cheech and Chong way. I'm to talk about.
Wow. Everybody must get stoned, exactly. Steven. Come on.
So that's pretty radical, isn't it? An Israeli band is pretty big in Iran, and that just shows how music can cross cultures and
that's right.
get past those political divides, which is pretty cool.
Are you a fan of that kind of stuff, Tony? Is that something you're always searching for? Is like new bands that are new sort of progressive, not in the progressive sense that we always talk about, but progressive in the metal world of new and different?
That's it right there. You nailed it. New and different. That's what really attracts me to it. You know, just anything. So,
cool.
Yeah.
Well, I love. No, go ahead.
No, I was just going to tell you my underrated.
Sure.
Band. Black and Blue. The first album. Come on, Geffen Records.
Totally.
It was incredible.
Totally.
Great
stuff. It
was
incredible, but it never really took off.
Mm-mm.
You know?
Yeah, I'm with you. Totally good. And from what I understand, there's a new Black and Blue record coming, actually.
Oh,
and
really?
I believe it's coming in the next couple of months. So I'm going to work my ass off to get... I know Joe and I have talked about this, about getting Jamie St. James on the show. He's awesome. That guy is just an unbelievable voice. Huge fan. Huge fan. Love Nasty Nasty. Love that band. Absolutely.
I even like the one album he did with them. Did he ever release an album, Freight Train Jane, or only demos?
You know, I don't know the answer to that.
Mm-mm.
I don't know the answer to that. But I know we saw him on stage with the band Harlot. I don't know if you're familiar with Harlot, but Harlot was another local band, and we went and saw Joe and I went and saw them, and Jamie came up and sang an encore with them. And the guy just rips. He's just so good. He's just a naturally unbelievable singer. He's just got huge, huge balls. You know what I mean? And the way that guy sings, it's pretty impressive. Not quite Dio stature, but pretty good nonetheless.
How do you know he's got big balls, Brad?
Who's got big balls?
How do you know this guy's got big balls?
I felt them.
Is he wearing those like Robert Plant tight trousers?
No. I touched them.
Ah,
with my long stick that went boom. Oh wait, sorry. Now I'm mixing my '80s metal up. Sorry about that.
Crocus, funny.
All right, Tony, anyway. We're going to go check out. I'm going to check out Myrath, and the Metal Warrior Princess is in the studio, so you could say hello to her if you want.
Hi, Rachel. How are you, babe?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing okay. What color is your hair today?
It's blonde.
She's back.
I'm back.
And I tell you what, Rachel is rocking some Robin Hood boots here.
Yeah.
It's a pair of jeans. Great boots, Rachel.
Rachel walks in the room and it becomes, this becomes like the fashion police. You know, especially like with me and Joe, who are like a couple of retards when it comes to that. But really now with me and Steven, it's like, you know, Dumb and Dumber talking about fashion. Right, Steven?
Yeah, absolutely. I feel bad. I should have dressed up.
Let me tell you, dude, if this was a fashion show, it would have been over in 2 seconds.
Stacey and Clinton from TLC's What Not to Wear being here and taking us out of here.
That's awesome.
We've got to arrest
him.
All
right, Tony, man. Thank you for the call, man. Talk to you soon.
You bet.
Yeah.
Bye, guys.
Later.
Take care.
Later. All right, so, Rach, we need to get you hooked up with headphones. We need to make that happen. How are you, though, by the way, really quick?
I'm doing good. I'm much better.
Yeah, we got it. I need you to talk straight into the mic. Steven, if you just want to move over to the side. There you go.
Hello.
There you are.
Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
Welcome.
Thank you.
So you're feeling better?
So much better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How was your week?
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah. In bed all week?
It was interesting. You know, maybe being sick is a little underrated because you get to stay in bed.
Right.
You get to lose weight.
Good point.
You get
point.
To sleep a lot.
It's true.
So,
that's right.
And then you get to be like incoherent and out of it. It's almost like having a drug trip.
Totally.
For free.
You know what? The only thing I don't like about that, though, is you have those weird sick dreams.
Yes.
You know, and like I find myself waking up in either like breathing heavy or obviously like in a weird sweat kind of deal. Like I'm a mess. I'll wake up and I'll feel like I've been sleeping for hours and maybe it's been 45 minutes.
Yeah.
But I feel completely like I've just run a mile or something.
Totally. Yeah. I had a dream that I lost 3 teeth. Yeah. I don't get it. I never had a dream like that before and I woke up and I'm like, oh my God.
Did your mouth hurt?
No.
Oh, that's so
weird. I don't even understand where it came from.
Yeah.
Sick dreams.
Yeah.
I think you've been watching that movie Marathon Man with
Dustin Hoffman.
Dustin Hoffman, yeah. Laurence Olivier.
Good movie.
Good movie.
You know what I just saw? I just saw The Fighter. Amazing.
Great, right?
Great movie.
Yeah. Did he deserve the Academy Award, Christian
totally.
Bale?
He is an amazing actor.
Telling you, if you haven't seen The Fighter, dude
Go
was amazing.
See it. Yeah.
I haven't seen The Fighter. Yeah, and I need to check that out. And I'm not a big boxing movie fan. Would I still enjoy it?
Whoever just called, I just screwed that up. By the way, you might want to call back. Sorry about that. It was my bad.
It's one of those movies that it's constantly moving. It's constantly going, and before you know it, the 2 hours is up, and you're like, wow, Christian Bale,
awesome.
Amazing.
Yeah, dude was great in that movie.
Yeah,
I agree.
All right, I've got to check it out.
Yeah, it's not so much about being. I think it's not so much a fighter movie, actually.
Right, it's not a boxing movie.
It's not really a boxing movie.
Yeah.
So,
good stuff, I agree.
Good stuff, good story.
Mm-hmm.
And at the end, they actually have the real brothers. And then you even see, wow, Christian Bale is amazing.
Was that on the DVD?
It was at the very end. We didn't even watch the DVD. We got it on pay-per-view.
Okay. We saw it in the theater, and so obviously they didn't have that in the theater. But that in particular, I was telling Joe this the other week. If you watch, you go on YouTube, but obviously you can do it on the DVD or on pay-per-view, and you can see the guy that he played and Christian Bale side by side, you get it.
Yeah.
You get it. Perfect. Unbelievable.
Exactly. Yeah.
Totally agree.
So you're listening to The Used Bin, and give us a call at 888-405-7440. And someone did just try to call in, and we botched the call. But
that's on me, by the way.
Don't give up on us.
My
bad. Give us another call. 888-405-7440.
Yes, sir.
And tell us what you've been listening to.
What have you been listening to, Stephen?
Oh, man, I've been listening to so much good stuff. But let me first start off telling you about John Wesley. Now, some of our listeners may well be familiar with John Wesley, but let me tell you a little bit about the man. John Wesley is a singer, songwriter, and guitarist who lives in Florida. And he's been on the scene for quite a while. He, in fact, got his real first big break when he was a roadie for Marillion back in the early 1990s.
Right.
And as legend has it, I think during an off night when the band was carousing in a bar, John Wesley got up and jammed. And I think at that point they realized that this cat could really play. He could play quite a mean guitar. And after that, they asked him to open some of their shows. And he's a great singer-songwriter, and he plays a mean guitar. So he does a lot of solo guitar work, and
he plays with Porcupine Tree now.
And now he plays with Porcupine Tree. In fact, he played with Fish, who used to be the singer of Marillion, and did an album with him, and through that met Stephen Wilson of Porcupine Tree. And so since then, John has been a member of the touring band of Porcupine Tree for the past decade or so, and he's more than a hired gun. He's really he's almost like the unofficial fifth member of the band. He plays a little bit of guitar on one or two of the albums and does backing vocals, but he's really a touring sideman. And in between all that, he's got a thriving solo career. So he has just released a brand new EP called the Lilypad Suite,
right?
Which was available for download this past weekend. And I've got to say, this is John Wesley up to a whole new level. He's really, when I spoke to him last year, he said that he felt that his songwriting had gone up to a whole new level. He was very excited about this new stuff. And I think that's really borne out by this new EP, which, wow,
Sorry, guys. You know what? I know someone's trying to call in, and we're having issues with the phones all of a sudden. It just will not answer. Let's try it again.
We're just trying to make some... So, the Lilypad EP. As John Wesley describes it, apparently, it's... He actually has a whole new studio album called Disconnect that's due out this summer. But he was writing a couple of songs for that album, and he noticed sort of a consistent theme running through several of them. And he sort of came up with a thematic EP called the Lilypad EP. And it's about the struggle of a young girl trying to come to terms with the absence of her father. And the EP over the course of seven tracks tells that story. Fantastic guitar work, great songs. It's very, very good. Go check it out. And if this EP is anything to go by, that album coming out over the summer called Disconnect is going to be a monster.
Well, I'm looking forward to it. You know, we had him in the studio. Wes came in studio, played for us acoustically. This was before the incident, I believe. And we tried to get some details on that record out of him, and of course he wouldn't budge. But he was just spectacular. Hang in there with me on the phones, guys. It's whatever. I can't seem to fix the phone, so I'm going to do it during the break, which we're going to go to here in a second. But
yeah, you know, he's also the nicest guy in rock and roll. And I think John is on tour, actually, at the moment on the East Coast. So go check him out. He's also going to be a support act at the Marillion Convention in Montreal next month.
Beauty. Let me go to the phones real quick, because I think I fixed it. Who's on the line here with us? Anyone?
Hey, what's up? What's up?
Who's this?
Kyle,
what's up, dude? Sorry about that. I don't know if you were trying to call in or not, man, but that was...
Yeah, I was. Someone else probably was as well. But,
yeah, that was... No, you know, that was... I don't know. The phone here is weird.
Know technology.
Yeah, well, I'll be honest with you, man. Sometimes if you push a wrong button by accident on this phone, it just completely... It's hard to get it back to... hard to get it back to, like, where it's clear so someone can call back in again. So, anyway, what's up, Kyle? How are you, man?
Good. How are you guys doing? You know, good to hear Steven. Too bad... Joe's not in, but I don't blame him since Marillion is my favorite band. But
is that your favorite band of all time?
Yeah, I kind of put Marillion as my favorite band and Kevin Gilbert as my favorite artist. But
great stuff.
If I had to choose one of the two, if I went on a desert island though, and I had to choose, you know, one, it would be Marillion because their catalog is so deep.
Wow. Okay, you know? That's fair. That's fair. All right, very good. What have you been listening to, man?
Oh, lots of stuff I'm sure none of the listeners have heard of, and you guys haven't heard of, but I could name a couple of things.
Yeah, stop us.
Careful, Steven's in the studio.
Locally, like, this guy named John Wright has this group called Leto and Wright that have been doing this kind of progressive, folky kind of stuff for, like, the last decade. Right. And last year they put out my second favorite record, this album called Children's Songs. It was four songs, one song being this 32-minute suite of different pieces, including Bartok and Chick Corea and Led Zeppelin and you name it.
Wow.
I just have been really enjoying that their group's catalog, because they have all these songs that are like Jethro Tull and Yes and Genesis and, you know. But he has this new group called the Galactic Cowboy Orchestra. Not the Galactic Cowboys, who I'm also a fan of, people like King's X, you know.
Yeah. Sure.
But they're a new group, and they're like Leto and Wright, they're kind of combining genres, bluegrass music and jazz rock. They even cover YYZ.
Really?
Huh.
But that's who does that? Who's the original band that does that?
Right.
Oh, Rush. Right?
I think what they called Ogilvy at one point. Rush Trivia.
Yeah, that's right. Mahogany
Blank.
They were blank.
Called Ogilvy at one point.
Right, that's right. So, yeah, I've heard of YYZ, I've heard of Rush, but yeah, so this sounds interesting.
If you like Mahavishnu Orchestra and Bela Fleck and the Dixie Dregs.
Love it, yeah.
They really mold those genres together. And Rush, the violin player who's married to actually John Wright, who's the bass player, Lisi Wright, she's a huge Rush fan. She's not been a Rush fan that long, so she's just discovering all those albums. In fact, she has a blog for the band, and she mentions how she'd love to play Losing It with the band live someday.
Really?
Hmm. Yes.
Wow. You know, I would like to get up there and play Ty Shan with the band one day too, but we'll see if that ever happens. So that's right.
You know, that's a strange thing about Rush. I can't ever recall the band ever having anyone get up and guest on stage with them.
No.
Can you? I don't think that's ever happened.
No.
Well,
no,
they joined the Foo Fighters, I know, but that wasn't one of their shows.
Right, that was at a Foo Fighters show.
That was, right, totally different. So,
I never did it with Kiss or with Uriah Heep. Was it Uriah Heep? Or UFO, I think it was? Or
they've never done
too
that.
Too bad, you know?
Yeah, no, they've never done that.
The only person who has ever joined on stage with Rush is a CNN reporter.
Who?
There was a CNN reporter last year who got to jam with them on stage, but that was before the show. So that doesn't
count. Oh, no, that doesn't. It's soundcheck? It doesn't count.
But that's
how
about it.
How odd is that?
Seriously.
A CNN reporter. Whatever. Very, very weird.
He's obviously the most deserving fan in the world to get that opportunity.
Yeah.
That have been around since the late 60s.
Right. Right. So this is a guy named John Wright you're talking about?
John Wright, yeah. He also plays with a guy named Greg Herridges, who's a really good progressive rock, who's a Rush fan, musician in Minnesota. We have all these artists in Minnesota that I am a fan of, but nobody else cares about other than these obscure niche genres of folk and bluegrass or jazz or whatever.
Well, as long as you qualify it by saying that they're, that they're Rush fans, that automatically puts them ahead of everybody else. So that's good. Just keep qualifying.
About this radio show.
Say it again.
He's friends with you guys on Facebook, actually, I believe.
Oh, is that right?
Oh, great. Maybe he's listening in.
Oh, well, very good. Well, I'd love to hear his stuff.
And their new record's really good. It's just, they actually do these cover albums, too, as a second disc. Mm-hmm. And they've covered, the Allman Brothers Johnny Cash and some other stuff. I mean, they have a bluegrass element in their sound, if you like bluegrass music. Have you ever listened to Bella Fleck?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, absolutely.
It's not metal, obviously. It's not hard rock, but it's still, the musicianship is in common with those kind of styles.
Right. Well, no, I definitely like all that kind of stuff. It sounds really interesting. So there's obviously a violin player, like you said, right?
Mm-hmm.
Great.
Yeah,
he's
the violin. They have four members, and they, they're dead. I just saw them on Saturday night. They put on a really good show. They're actually going out east and playing six or seven gigs. I posted something on my blog about it.
Right.
But,
all right, very good.
I'm seeing Fair to Midland tomorrow night, and Judgment Day on Saturday. We played with Dredge, and a lot of concerts are coming
Dredge,
up, of course.
Right there.
Is that Fair to Midland show? Is that the Scale the Summit tour with who's
Periphery.
In Periphery? Right, yeah, that's very good. You have to make sure you get there to see Scale the Summit, right?
Yeah, I saw them. At Progressive Nation. I'll definitely check them out again this time.
Have you heard this new record?
I've given it a go or two. I think it's better than their last one. I mean, you still haven't gotten around to talking to the guy because of the conflict the last time we were going to interview the member.
Yeah, you know what happened, which was weird, is that it turned out that was the opening night of the show. The opening night of the tour, because one of the guys from Fair to Midland had some surgery and he wasn't quite ready yet. So, yeah.
Yeah, he had some, I don't know the exact details of it, but he had some unexpected surgery and three dates that were supposed to play in their native Texas didn't happen, so...
Yeah, so that was the issue. So the opening night of the tour turned out to be our show, and I guess what happened was they just weren't sure set times and all that kind of stuff. And believe it or not, it turned out to work out good on our end because that was Joe's birthday show, and it was a bit of a zoo in here. So worked out pretty good for us.
Brain check,
Yeah, we'll get them at some point for sure because I really like those guys, and I really want to support them because anybody that can go out there and make instrumental prog records in this day and age and go out and tour and be somewhat successful at it is. I would love to be supportive. I'm on that bandwagon for sure.
So
the Progressive Nation thing I'd heard their name before that, but that really helped them out a lot. And obviously Portnoy had heard about them or heard about them from someone.
Well, that was a happy accident because of the Pain of Salvation deal where they couldn't get over here because of the record label stuff. And
it's not their fault. I know.
No, that was a label
thing. A lot of people though.
Yeah.
I mean, I've seen Pain of Salvation three times, but there's so many fans in North America that never saw them.
Yeah.
There's one chance they were going to finally come over here and it didn't happen. But
Listen, as much as I'd like to see Pain of Salvation, and Joe's really turned me on to that band a little bit more because I wasn't a huge fan until recently, but I was so unbelievably thrilled to be able to see Zappa play Zappa and Big Elf and Scale the Summit on that tour. I mean, that was like heaven for Joe and I. I mean, Joe and I were sitting in maybe the sixth row at the Greek Theater here in L.A., which is this beautiful outdoor theater made famous, of course, by Neil Diamond, God bless him. Because Steven, you don't bring your flowers.
I thought that was Russell Brand who made it famous.
Yeah.
That movie.
Yes.
I saw that movie. Oh, what a piece of crap. I, 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 yeah. pretend no to go halfway through. That. Terrible.
Yeah,
terrible.
No, I can't help you there.
Avoid it.
But anyway, so we were sixth row at that at the Greek, and it was just, it was an epic, epic night of music. Really, really great. And Scale the Summit was fantastic.
So let me.
The unknowns and then the Zappa stuff, you know, and then you get Dream Theater.
Yeah, it just it turned out to be the last show with Portnoy. Wait, did I say the last show with Portnoy?
Watch the space. So here's a quick question for you. Are you, as a Marillion fan, are you going to any of the upcoming conventions?
No, I mean, I tried it out. I've done this a couple of different times, being that it's in Montreal, and it runs my budget at least into four figures, I believe. But right. Some people don't really see that as a challenge financially. But it's great that they're coming over here, and I know there's obviously concerns about trying to tour the States because they lose 30% of the money up front to the venues and everything and to the U.S. government.
Mm-hmm.
I've always wanted them to consider try to do one of these conventions in a place like Chicago or Las Vegas, which is more centrally located.
Mm-hmm, right.
But I guess the finances works a lot better in Montreal, but what can I do? You know, I did see them twice. Had I never seen them, because I saw them in Chicago twice, actually, when they toured for Marbles.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And the
great
trio.
Show.
You know, I would have gone over to Europe to see them because, you know, how can you wait so long to see your favorite band, you know?
That's right. Well, so. hopefully that changes a little bit, or you're able to get over into Montreal or something to that effect, but
I'd love to.
Yeah,
I wanted to chime in on the overrated, underrated thing, actually, too.
Okay.
Yeah.
The underrated, I want to bring up a band that I absolutely adore, but they are like one of the most obscure bands. They're not around anymore. They're called Apes and Androids, and they actually previously were owned by the band by the name Call Florence Powell, but in 2008 they put out this record called Blood Moon, which I could like put in my grave. I've listened to it so many times, and I can't get enough of it.
Hmm.
I went to this science fiction convention dressed as one of the members of their band, actually.
Wow.
Wow.
It's, to describe the music, though, it's sort of a mixture of different styles where it's like David Bowie and Pink Floyd and Prince and Queen. They have these really great falsetto vocals, but they have a sense of humor about it, almost kind of androgynous in a way, sort of.
Huh.
And nobody knows. I mean, the people that have heard them love them, but nobody's heard them, and they broke up. You know,
Interesting.
It depresses me. That one album, you know, you can't stop listening to. Maybe you've had that experience, you know.
Yeah, well, of course. I mean, there's a million of those kinds of bands, but I'm still stuck on the fact that you dressed up as one of the guys and went to a sci-fi convention. What do they look like?
They look like, okay, I got this shirt off of Amazon.com that was like one of those skeleton rib shirts, you know, that people wore in the 80s.
Yeah.
I've seen pictures of some of the members of their band live wear those, and then they wore bandanas and headbands and like necklaces and face paint and stuff. I didn't get the face paint, but that's probably for the next time. And then I got this guitar thing. It's like it's not an actual guitar, and it's not a Guitar Hero guitar. It's called Paper Jams. I got this at Target for like $18. It looks like a guitar. It's like a game.
Interesting.
And so we were doing karaoke. We do karaoke all night at these science fiction conventions, and I was getting up on stage with whoever's doing the singing and playing like air guitar on this guitar.
Very interesting.
So, yeah, they were known for their outrageous shows. They only played like three or four shows. They're from Brooklyn.
I'm glad they don't look like Gwar, because I would have been extremely concerned if you walked around looking like that. Yeah,
I gotta say,
Odorous Urungus. That's who it is, right? Isn't that who his name is? Odorous Urungus. Just don't go around looking like that.
I would never wear those like masks that the Gwar guys wore.
Kyle, how much would it cost us for you to walk around in your normal daily routine dressed up like one of the Gwar guys? Like, how much would it take to get you to do that?
Probably at least, I don't know.
You know what?
Maybe an airplane trip out to L.A. to, like, sit in for a show with you guys sometime. Maybe that would work.
That's a good answer. Or the other answer is you should price out a trip to the Marillion convention and then call us back with that number.
That's true. It probably wouldn't be quite that much, but it'd be pretty close.
Fair enough.
Did you ever see, like, David Bowie clips, you know, when he was all in his glam stage?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's kind of what they, I mean, their videos on YouTube, they have these, like, cheerleaders, and they have these most, the most outrageous concerts ever, I guess.
Right.
But they were so rare, and I never got to see them, but I can't just help but get sucked in, just love what they did.
Yeah.
They even have, like, this message of, with this girl calling them up, you know, yelling at them on their voicemail, "You're fucking worthless capitalist motherfuckers, and I hate you, all of you."
Careful now, language.
You know, it's like humor with, you know, brilliant songwriting and melody and energy and, you know, psychedelics. It's,
right.
I don't know. It's nothing. I've never heard anything quite like it. I mean, of Montreal that you could compare them to, maybe. Have you heard of them?
Sure, of course.
You know, of Montreal sort of do the androgynous thing and to a point, but these guys are much better singers than of Montreal.
Right.
You know, they do the Queen, you know, Bohemian Rhapsody kind of vocal harmonies that you don't hear very often.
All right, that's interesting. So that's good. All right, Kyle.
Thanks, Kyle.
We got to cut you loose, pal. We got to go. I'm going to go play a tune.
Good to hear you guys again. You know, welcome. 2 weeks that Joe's coming back.
Yeah, we probably won't get him next week as he will be flying. There's a slight chance, but I doubt it. But definitely the week after. And then in April, we're booking a ton of stuff for April. So we're going to have a bunch of guests and it'll be good.
Cool, man. I'm looking forward to it.
All right, man. Okay. Thank you for the call, Kyle.
Have
Take
a good
care.
Night.
All right, buddy. Talk to you later.
Now, if you've been trying to call in, do keep trying, and we'd love to hear from you.
Right. So, yeah. Here's the deal with the phones: is for those of you that don't know, is that we can only take one call at a time. So if somebody's on the line and you're listening to the show, and someone's on the line, obviously we can't answer the phone, which is why it goes to a voicemail, and you get frustrated, and you probably end up not liking Steven very much. And I don't want you to not like Steven, because he's my friend, and Rachel is Steven's friend too, and we like Steven a lot.
We're very fragile.
Yes.
Psychologically.
That's
so,
right. All right, well, you need a hug, so I'm going to go and play a tune.
Great.
How's that? I'm not sure
what you're lining up.
I don't know. I have some long songs, and I got some short songs. Let's play some live Metallica.
Okay.
Now, here's the thing, is I know that when I had my, I didn't actually have my son, but my wife had my son, but I was there when she had him because he's actually part mine. And when I did that, Joe was in studio here, and he handled this whole bad boy by himself and played a ton of tunes. And you know that Joe is the master of the bootleg and the master of the live recording, legal or illegal or both. And I am not, is the whole point. So you're not getting any of that cool stuff from me. But this, I do have this, and I got this off of the Live Metallica website, which you can obviously get as well. But this is Seek and Destroy from December 18th, 1983, from the Agora Ballroom in Cleveland, Ohio. And I'm going to try not to fuck this up. So enjoy.
Okay, we're going to do one right now. I want everyone in this whole fucking place to scream along with me on this one. I hope the most of you know it. This is entitled Seek and Destroy. Want to see those heads bobbing out there? Come on.
we don't take anymore. Say goodbye to the world you live in. You always get chicken and now you're giving. Right on a wee hunt, you will be dying for darling death. Right on a wee hunt, you will be dying for darling death. So Jane, come on now, shake and destroy.
You guys are fucking nuts!
Used Bin Radio. What are you listening to?
welcome back into the Usbin. Can everybody hear me now?
I can hear loud and clear.
Loud and clear, Rach, no? Something's up with these headphones here. All right, we'll get them fixed. Okay, so that was a little Metallica, old Metallica, from 1983, from the Agora Ballroom in Cleveland, Ohio, my hometown, and that's why you got it, because I'm a selfish bastard. Now that we've established that, we have got on the line our old friend who we were just talking about not too long ago, Mr. John Wesley. Wes, how are you, pal?
Good, how are you doing?
I'm good, man. So just so everyone knows, you've been trying to call in, and we haven't been able to get to the phone, mainly because we're a bunch of jackasses.
That's all right. It happens.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm in the studio by myself. There's no Joe. Well, not really by myself, but with no Joe tonight. So the brains
right,
is not in the operation.
Right.
Yeah. But the beauty is.
Thank you.
Steven is in there, huh?
Steven is here, and Rachel, the Metal Warrior Princess, is here, who I don't know if you met last time you were here.
I didn't meet her, no.
Yes, she is the queen of everything metal and evil and dark.
Cool.
But she's very sweet and yes. Lovely, and you got to meet her sometime.
Sweet and lovely. Oh, fantastic. There I'd love go. To.
So, Wes, what have you been up to, man? How are you?
I'm writing bar now with Clam on bass. Actually, our guitar player, Dean Tidy, is sitting next to me. And a producer, Steven, you might be familiar with. Chris Sheldon is in the backseat.
Oh, no way. Fantastic.
That's pretty.
Yeah.
You got the whole band together.
The whole band, huh?
Yes, we got the band back together.
Good. Well, let me ask you, before we get to talk about this this new record that you have, I want to know what you've been listening to lately.
What have I been listening to lately? I haven't listened to anything lately. All I've been listening to is this.
Really?
I mean, I always listen to, well, as Steven knows, Patty Griffin and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
But last couple of weeks, I can't even remember. Well, then there's, you know, the Ocean Size record before that. Listen to that.
Very good.
And they just split up. Ocean Size.
Did, yeah.
Tragic.
The new Elbow. Yes, the new Elbow is fabulous.
Oh, great record.
You know, I just saw, by the way, speaking of Elbow, aren't they going to play Reading and or Leeds?
I think
they're,
so.
they're co-headlining. What's
they're
that?
Not sure.
They're actually going to be the band opening for U2 at Glastonbury. They have the second top headlining slot on Friday night.
Wow.
And they're a great live band. You know, the singer Guy Garvey is a very charismatic, charming kind of guy, and really, really good live band. They're going to be playing Coachella too on April 19th.
Elbow is?
Yeah, they are.
Right.
So if you're in the Southern California area.
I think that's the only redeeming value maybe for Coachella, because Coachella just blows this year. It really does.
Well, there is PJ Harvey.
You played Coachella last year though, right?
Yes, we did. We played a pretty good slot. It was a good time.
Right.
It's really good for us.
Joe was there, and he said that John played with Porcupine Tree, by the way. So, I mean, and Joe said it was just fantastic. Like, the reception was really good.
Yeah, it was over the moon. And there were a lot of, you know, press people that wouldn't normally be tuned into that kind of music that took a chance on seeing the band and really enjoy what we were doing. And it opened a lot of doors for us. So it's hopefully we're going to get to do it again.
That's fantastic.
Wes, I know that you're a big Radiohead fan, and in fact, Brad and I have just been having a profound disagreement about the merits of Radiohead. I think they're brilliant and amazing. Brad just thinks they're underrated.
No, so, I don't think they're underrated. I think they're overrated.
Overrated, I beg your pardon. And so I'm wondering if you've listened to their new record, The King of Limbs.
I haven't heard any of it. In the last 3 weeks, I've just been so buried in what I've been doing that I honestly haven't really been tuned into any other music. It's kind of weird. I get, you know, put in a 10 or 12 hour day at the studio, go home, and literally just shut everything off, not want to hear anything. So as much as a fan as I am of the band, I haven't heard the new record.
All right. Huh. Well, I got something to look forward to. Why don't you just quickly set Brad straight on Radiohead?
All right, let me set this up for you, Wes.
I love them.
Let me set this up for you. This was the deal, was that we were playing this game called Overrated, Underrated. And
oh, dear.
Yes. So the idea of the game is when you find a band or an artist or whomever, and are they, according to the way the press sees them, and just their overall stature? Are they overrated or underrated?
Well, let's take a vote. I've got three very experienced musicians in the car. Let's take a vote. Radiohead, overrated or underrated? Mr. Sheldon?
I don't think they're overrated or
Mr. Sheldon says they are what they are, neither over or under.
So they're right on the money, right on the money.
Miss Tidy thinks they're very good and great, but very underwhelmed by the new thing.
So that
and
would...
me, I think they're great, and I haven't heard the new thing.
Okay. Let me tell you why I think they're overrated. I'm going to go through this again, but I just think that I've never seen a bad word written about that band. Not, I mean, they're the critics' darling. I think they could fart for 45 minutes on an album, and it would be the greatest thing since sliced bread. And truthfully, albums like The Bends and OK Computer and even Pablo Honey, I love those records. I think they're really good. But then you get into like Amnesiac and Kid A, and I'll call you, man. I can't listen to Pops and Clicks all day long on an album. It just drives me nuts.
I'll go with you there. I mean, there's definitely some things that you know, we'll get the skip. But, I mean, you know, every now and again, you know, you got to give every artist that.
Right.
You know.
Right. I liked
In
Rainbows.
Any artist, you know. I'm sorry?
I liked In Rainbows. I thought In Rainbows was a little bit better.
Yeah, In Rainbows, great record. Yeah. And I really liked, they did that little live thing from the basement within Rainbows, and I really liked that.
Oh, that was great.
Yeah. Really good.
Yeah.
What I like about Radiohead is I love when there's melody. Like, I just don't, I just can't stand when there's no melody and it's just, you know, the melody is like, or Pops and Clicks. I feel like I just keep waiting and waiting and waiting, and it never gets there.
Well, let me tell you, when Kid A came out, I think everyone was kind of flummoxed by that record, and it did actually get some bad reviews at the time, and I think has lately been reappraised, and in fact, topped a couple of polls of, you know, the best album of the past decade. And you know what? It really is a good record, but it is one of those that it just has to seep in a little bit, and you have to sort of get on their frequency and their wavelength. And there's a lot of lot of beauty, and you know, there's
and
a song.
I kind of applaud them for trying to take a chance and be a bit adventurous. You know,
right. And this new record is definitely it's their least kind of
accessible.
And it's also one you just gotta kind of listen to it and let it seep in. It's definitely not their best record, but it's got a lot of redeeming moments. And I really love it. Any Radiohead fan's gonna love it.
Cool. I'm looking forward to it. You know, like I said, my head has been too filled with what I've been up to. So
right. Well, let's talk about it then. So the Lilypad Suite. That's the name of the new record, right?
Yes, it is.
And is it out?
Yes, it is. Well, the physical copy isn't. Here's the kind of story. We finished tracking the last track on Thursday.
Uh-huh.
The last mix came in Friday. By Friday evening, he had sent us the masters. By 3 o'clock Saturday afternoon, it was for sale.
That is
as a download.
That is fantastic.
The physical copy is about 2 weeks.
Right. Technology is just incredible, isn't it?
Yeah. It is.
So you must have been really just eager to get the stuff out there then. You weren't sitting around. You were getting this out there as soon as possible.
Yeah, I mean, we're to that point, you know, Dean and I and everyone involved in creating it, that, you know, the only reason to do this anymore is to get the music for people to hear it. And if they can't hear it, there's no reason to do it anymore because the income certainly isn't enticing.
Right.
You know, Dean's in his 40s, I'm in our 40s, been doing this our whole lives. We've both been in situations where the money was really good, and then you end up at a certain point in your life, well, it's like, well, the money's not so good anymore.
Yeah.
Do I want to continue to do this? And when we made a decision to move forward with what we were doing, it was like, we're just going to have to do this because we love it, and hopefully the income and the ability for us to pay for what the album cost us to do will come, you know?
Right.
And so at that point, it's like, there's no more record, there's no more gatekeepers. There's no one saying, well, we're going to have to sit on this for a while and prep this and prep that. It's like, you know what? I know people. I have people that want to hear this music. We finished it today. We're very, very happy with it because through the whole process, we had been in quality control, so there was no reason to sit on it. It was like, let's just do this. Because as soon as we can get this out there and get it going and get people interested, we're going to do another one. And then when we're done with that one, we're going to do another one. And that's the reality of what we are now.
It's awesome. I love that. I mean, that's the way it should be. And it, as a yeah. as a big fan of always hearing new music and, you know, loving the artists that you love, I always yeah. that's exactly what I want. I love that attitude, you know. And part of me misses the days of, you know, a record maybe every 18 months kind of thing, you know, record, yeah. big tour, you know, can't yeah. wait to stand in line at the warehouse or at sure. Tower, you know what I mean, and get that record. I remember being at Tower Records in Las Vegas, and I bought the Metallica Master of Puppets and Poison's Look What the Cat Dragged In all on the same day. Like, so part of me misses that. On the other hand, I love the fact that I can get an email from you letting me know that this EP is available, which I did get, actually, and letting me know that the EP is available, and download it now, and I can listen to it within 3 minutes. Love that.
Yeah. And you know, and also people have the option of the hard copy, and that's only going to take 2 weeks. And the only time that's going to take is the actual physical time it takes to produce it and ship it.
Right.
Again,
right.
No gatekeepers, yeah. you know?
It's great. Anything different between the two? Is there anything different if I went out and bought the hard copy as opposed to the downloaded version?
No, just a really nice 6-panel digipack with some really nice artwork and, you know, the lyrics and, you know, a little bit about the story, which you get that when you download it. But it's, you know, it's nice to hold it. And honestly, I mean, unless you do the high quality flax and burn them to a CD or, you know, like, you know, if you're in your car, I'm of that mind that MP3s don't sound as good as a CD or, you know, a high quality flax or something right. like that. So that's the only real difference, you know.
Got it.
One of the nice things about the EP, in fact, is that you can download it on a variety of audio formats. So if you want FLAC
yes.
or, yeah. you know, a sort of a lossless digital file, you can do that. Or if you just want an ordinary MP3, you've got that option, too. I thought that was great.
Yeah. Yeah, and there's no price difference between the two. When you buy it, it gives you the option. You have complete control of that. And, you know, I firmly believe in that. I mean, some bands will release the FLACs at a higher price.
Right.
And I'm just like, you know, man, I just, you know, if I can just cover the costs and make a decent living, we're all happy.
Right.
But I really want to give people what they want, you know?
Yeah. Well, without getting too knee deep into your business, but I'm going to try anyway.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
If it's not about sort of making the money at this point, you know, with the putting out the material, where do you make the money? Is it live?
No, you know what? It's the long tail theory. You'll make a little bit in a lot of different places. Like, we're going to make a little bit off of this, hopefully.
Mm-hmm.
And then, you know, through that, someone might discover my back catalog, because I have an extensive back catalog.
Sure.
And even though most of it is available for free as an MP3 download, some people want the high-quality copy, and they want the hard copy. So someone who buys this and discovers it might buy something old.
Right.
And that provides a little bit of income. And then they might come to a show.
Right.
And that provides a little bit of income. And then they might buy a T-shirt. So, you know, you're really trying to make income from several different sources now, because trying to earn income from just music alone isn't enough. You're just not, it's not going to happen. And now that opens the door for two things. Yes, you have to spend more money making more music because, you know, contrary to popular belief, the act of creating music is not free. you know,
I heard a rumor.
There's a rumor it costs a little bit. So another way that, you know, it opens the door for my creativity is the ability to put more out there when I have the time and the ability to do so. But that also helps the income stream.
Right.
So you're going to make less off of more. Does that make sense?
Sure.
Mm-hmm.
So the only way to really survive now is to be able to do what you do and love and not be stifled by the lack of ability to create, you know. And just put it out there. And it helps you be able to do it through being able to earn income off that long tail.
Right.
So let's actually tell listeners out there that, in fact, if you go to John Wesley's website, and if you give John Wesley your email address, in fact, you can download most of John's back catalog. And yeah, if you albums. Haven't checked it out, you go check it out. You don't know what you're missing. So
It's completely free, and that was born out of frustration. I was stuck in a couple record deals in Europe. They hadn't released it in the States. The last record never even garnered an English language review.
Right.
And yet, if you wanted to buy that record, by the time you paid shipping duties, all the crap that went with it, it was $27.
Wow.
And so I'm spending my life creating this, and the end cost to a consumer is $27. So I cut a couple deals where I got my own stuff back, got the rights to it back, and I said, I want people to hear it. If people don't hear it, I can't do this anymore.
Right.
You know?
Right. Yeah,
I'll figure out a way to make money.
At $27,
you know?
Bucks, you're alienating more people than you are gaining fans.
Absolutely.
And what's the point of that?
And again, for me, I mean, we all need to make money. To sit here and say it's not about money would be lying.
Sure.
Because I've got a house, I have a car, I have grandsons.
Right.
I have dogs. I have to support them. But even deeper than that is the fact that I've created this. And if no one hears it, it makes me sick. You know
right.
what I mean? So my thought was, I will figure out a way to make money. But you've got to hear this and share it. And get something out of it. So.
Now, Wes, I was telling Brad earlier on, I just think you've gone up to a whole new level with this stuff.
I hope so.
I think on the Lilypad Suite EP, and the production is fantastic. It makes your previous album Shiver sound like a bunch of demos almost. There's a very
wow.
It's a very kind of it's a very rich, beautiful, lush production. There's a lot going on. It's a real kind of headphones record. And I was playing Brad some of the stuff just before the show. He was knocked out by it too.
Yeah.
What do you think has been the difference? Because you said that you felt your songwriting had gone up to a whole new level. You were telling me that your wife, who hasn't necessarily been a big John Wesley music fan, she's enthused by the new stuff too. What do you think has been the difference that you've gone up to this whole new level?
Hours, time doing it. You know. I've trashed probably three albums of songs in the last 5 years. It's been 5 or 6 years since I put out a record.
Wow.
And, you know, Shiver, I love that record. And all, you know, I love all those old records. They're great. But, you know, I wanted to up my game. And I wasn't going to put anything out until I had upped my game. And that's kind of what took this long, you know. I realized I was going to have to do it myself the next time, and I was going to have to do something that meant something to me.
Right.
And so in the course of writing my next record, which is called Disconnect, I've got most of that, a lot of that recorded, the songs for the Lilipad Suite started to surface. And there was a running theme through that, and that's what caused me to create the collection, was there was a theme through all of these songs that had to deal with that same subject matter.
What's the theme? Can you talk about that a little bit?
Sure, yeah. And to answer Steven's questions real quick, was time. I spent a lot of time on this record, you know.
Mm-hmm.
We slammed it out in 3 weeks, but the prep for it and every waking moment of that 3 weeks was spent doing this record.
Mm.
And so that's really the difference. With Shiver, I was restricted time-wise, restricted budget-wise,
mm-hmm.
but this time I just made some decisions to not allow any restrictions.
Good for you.
I think you can really hear the inspiration on it, and it's, you know, you wouldn't be able to tell that it was created so quickly, and you know, some artists take a long time in a record and they slave over it, and they get so sort of embroiled in the process that they start to lose the trees from the forest, and then it sort of becomes overworked, and so to have that inspiration to work quickly and fast and to get it out there has got to be a very liberating experience.
It was, and you know, I honestly, I mean, I'd be lying if I said I didn't learn a lot off the cats I work with.
Tell us a little bit about those guys. About Dean, who listeners may not know about. Dean Tidy.
Dean is. He grew up. One of his best mates was Giles Martin, and Giles Martin is, of course, George Martin's son,
right?
Who's a producer in his own right today.
Sure.
He produced the Love record, which won a Grammy, and all kinds of things. And, you know, his best friend's dad was, well, Sir George.
Wow.
And so Dean kind of grew up as a musician in that environment. And when he was very young, he was doing sessions with Sir George and all those guys. And and in that whole London thing, and he was kind of in that circle. So he immediately had exposure to a lot of guys doing a lot of great things. And his two best friends are, one of them was just in the car with us. They got out while I was talking. But Chris Sheldon, the Foo Fighters.
Were we boring them?
Chris Sheldon. No, I had to drop them off. We were riding around, and it was time to go.
They wouldn't be the first people that I've bored, by the way. Just so you know, I'm not offended if that's the case.
They weren't bored. We were out at a redneck bar on the river doing some drinking, so... It was
fair enough. Fair enough.
And, Chris Sheldon's one of Dean's best friends. And then the guy that mixed this record, Steve Orchard, who, of course, worked on the incident for Porcupine Tree.
Yeah.
Yep.
He went to work at Air Studios in 1985. So you get cats like that, and our drummer, Mark, who did a lot of engineering on the record. He's been engineering since 1990. So you get all these guys with all this experience, and then, Dean coming in, bringing a completely different style of guitar playing than me.
Right.
And meshing the two styles, and, him having that vision to say, well, look, what we would do if we had an unlimited budget wherever we were is we would just take this to that place.
Right.
And because, I was in my own studio, I was determined not to be hampered by budget or whatever, we would just go there. And things that I might have not done before for lack of time or lack of budget or lack of the ability to have someone next to me going, just do it, just go for it, and then he was also the master of keeping the noises. And if you really, really listen to records, you're going to hear a lot of amp buzz. You're going to hear things that the mix engineer, Steve Orchard, incorporated into the mixes. He didn't leave them in out of not paying attention. He actually cut them and moved them and used them.
Right.
So there are sounds in this record that we just left on there, and he used them in a creative fashion.
That's awesome.
And there's a lot of that. I mean, there are no keyboards on this record. I've already had one or two people go, man, the electronica aspect is great. I'm like, no keyboards. All guitar.
Did you guys do this thing, did you do it live?
No, we cut the rhythm tracks live, and then we just would sit in the studio, all day long, going, what do you want to do now? Ooh, this thing wibbles.
Right.
Well, let's wibble it in this key for this long, and when the feedback comes, you reach over and grab that and then hit this delay.
Right, right.
And that's what we did.
That's awesome.
And, that's the songs were already there. The songs hold up acoustically. So then all we had to do was to experiment and see where we wanted to take it. And, a lot of times in my career and Dean's career, too, we've been restricted.
Mm-hmm.
And in Steve's career as a mix engineer, he's been restricted. Our goal for this record and future endeavors is to not have those restrictions.
Right.
If we feel like it's good and it's something that, is different or a different sound, we wanted to go for it. And to be fair, I learned a lot of that attitude from working with Steve Wilson. Right. I mean,
he's pretty fearless.
He's really good about that.
Yeah, yeah.
Speaking of which, have you played this new EP to any of your Porcupine Tree bandmates? Have you heard any feedback from other people?
I sent it to Steve, and you have to understand the kind of relationship we all have. We have kind of a don't ask, don't tell relationship. We all give music to each other that's all our own stuff, and no one ever talks about it.
Right.
It's just like, because the whole praise thing is just doesn't exist in Porcupine Tree. You'll never come off stage and have someone go, awesome show, mate.
Weird?
It takes some getting used to.
Yeah, I would think so.
Yeah.
I mean, naturally, as a human, you're looking for something, right? Some sort of feedback, good, bad, or indifferent.
But, Steve is he doesn't read reviews. He doesn't, his whole motto is create music in a vacuum.
Right.
So he wouldn't be the kind of guy to give me an opinion of the music because in his eyes, my opinion doesn't really matter. What do you think of it?
Right.
And I kind of learned a lot of that from him.
Right.
And that enabled me to take some chances on this record was like, well, what do I think of it? And because so many times you're going to go, well, don't do that because they might not like it. Well, who are they?
Right.
You know, and that's a big Steve Wilson thing. And honestly, I learned a lot of that from him.
I get that. That's pretty cool. I mean, I that's why I think all those records are, you know, they're a little bit different. And, you know, they reek of individuality and art, all those records.
Yeah.
Like it or not like them, it's just sort of the way it is. So I guess I get that.
And it really opened some doors for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm not beholden to a record company. I don't have anyone saying, you need a single.
Right.
I'm like, dude, I just wrote an entire record about, a young girl who is distant from her father and is going through a trauma, and other people that I know that have gone through the same thing. That's not commercial. that's not even,
right.
That's a tough movie to watch, much less an album.
Yeah.
But it exists because no one could stop me. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. 100% it does. I think it's fantastic. I mean, it's creativity at its peak.
Yeah, I mean, there were these things that, as I was writing, there were these things that were coming out, and they were honest feelings and, honest thoughts and observations. And I many times in the disc, the point of view is from that young person.
Yeah.
And you can't do that if you're writing up, you know?
Right. Yeah.
And so people even talk to me about the name, the Lilypad Suite. That's kind of gay. And I'm like, well, man, it is what it is.
Right.
The name is Lilypad,
Well,
and
I don't think it's gay.
It no, So
just so you know.
6 years ago, I would not have made this record.
Yeah. That's amazing. Real quick, if you're just joining us, we've been surprised by a phone call from John Wesley, who has a new EP out called the Lilypad Suite, which you can get at his website, which is johnwesley.com, right? Is that right?
John-Wesley.com. Okay. JohnWesley.com will get you some very fine Methodist sermons from the John Wesley of the Methodist Church.
Wow. Okay, so don't go there.
John-Wesley will get you some good music.
Right. John-Wesley.com, and you can get all his records there, and the new one, like I said, is the Lilypad Suite. I mean, I'm really excited to hear it, and it just sounds like it sounds really intense. And I remember when you were here, it had to have been maybe a year and a half ago when you came in the studio, because it was right before the incident came out, if I remember correctly, because we were really needling you about getting some dirt on that record, and you weren't budging.
Yep.
So,
yep.
And so you were well in the process of making this record at that time, right?
I had written some of the songs, absolutely, and they were disturbing me. I'm like, why am I writing this? why did that come out? What did that come out of?
Right.
And, so I started bringing some of those out and playing them live to try and give them some life. And, I just like, there are people that can relate to this because, there are people that have experienced these things. In many cases, it's a shared experience.
Right.
And even if you have an experience, you know someone who has. And I just felt like this deserves life, you know?
Yeah.
And, that was kind of it,
It's exciting. It sounds really great. And I wanted to ask you a couple of quick more questions about this, which is, are you touring? Is there a tour on tap, or...
Yes. Luckily, through the Porcupine Tree Connection, I've hooked up with the agency group, and they've booked a major market run for me starting in the first week of April. So I'm playing right outside of Baltimore in Eastern Maryland. I'm playing in Philly, playing in New York City, Boston, and of course playing with the Marillion guys again at the Montreal Convention, which is more fun than the law allows.
That's where Joe is, actually. Joe's in Holland. Well, he's on his way to Holland for the Marillion Convention.
He's going to have too much fun.
Yeah, Joe is like, Joe, I mean, you've talked to him about this, but he is like, besides being a Marillion fanatic, but he does this thing, I think, every year that they've done it, I think he's gone, no matter where it is. So, with the exception of Montreal, because from what I understand, it's the same convention.
Yeah.
But he's excited about that.
I wish I could go this year.
Yeah. Are you coming out here? Will you be touring out here in L.A.?
If this major market run goes good with the agency group and they convince some promoters to bring me out, I will. But you know how I teach out at GIT a couple times, a couple weeks a year?
Mm-hmm.
I'm scheduled to do that at the end of June, and I'm going to try and put in some shows around that.
Well,
I should be out there in June.
Oh, great.
That's great. Well, Whenever that happens, please let us know. So if there's if you can make some time for us, we'd love to either have you in the studio.
Love to come visit.
We had such a good time last time you were here. I think we were fairly new at what the hell we were doing, so I don't even well, actually, it sounded really good.
I think I played.
Yeah,
I
know you did.
It sounded great.
Yeah, I know you played well. I just think we sounded like jackasses.
Fun.
But come on, that's what we do though, right?
Absolutely.
Can I hit you with some Porcupine Tree questions real quick before you go?
Do it.
Okay.
Please do.
So,
yeah.
What is the status with Porcupine Tree? On hiatus, making a record? Are they?
Yeah,
what's going on?
You know, Porcupine Tree, over the last couple of years, expanded and became a really big thing. And it became all-consuming for all of us, especially Steven.
Right.
And Steven, he can't be trapped. You know what I mean? He is an extremely creative individual, and he has several things he has to do. And I think he felt that Porcupine Tree had become too all-encompassing, too much of a cocoon.
Hmm.
So as soon as we finished, he blew out of it. And, I mean, he's already got a new solo record track.
Right.
I mean, you know, well, he'd been tracking that over the last year.
And the Blackfield record's coming out.
And a Blackfield record.
Right.
And, I mean, you know, it was like, let me out of this box and I will make music and mix music. I think right now he's actually mixing the Opass record.
Wow. Nuts.
So, you know,
he doesn't take
Porcupine
a break.
Tree's not even on his radar.
Got
you
it.
Know?
Well, was part of that because of the size of this incident tour? I mean, I know you guys did the big Radio City tour, which the big Radio City show, right? Played like front 6,000 people, and then you guys did Royal Albert Hall. I mean, is that the biggest? Yeah. Is that to date anyway? The biggest that Porcupine Tree has been?
Yeah, definitely. And like in some places in Europe, like Holland, we were selling out the Heineken Music Hall two or three times in a row.
Wow.
So it was the biggest and it was the longest. We were consumed in that with rehearsals over 14 or 15 months.
Wow.
And that takes a pretty good chunk of your creative energy.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Well,
I think last time we actually saw you was on the Coheed when you guys did the tour with Coheed and Cambria.
Yep.
And, right, and that was not long after you had done a full run with the incident here in the States anyway, and then had done Coachella, and then you were back for a second run and then headed to Radio City, if I'm not mistaken.
Absolutely. That is correct.
I was excited when you guys
traveling.
Did that.
Yeah, and we needed to do that.
Yeah.
But again, Steven isn't one of those individuals that, you know, a lot of bands, when they're on an album cycle like that, they're done. They're not going to have anything to do with music, and they're not going to even think about music again until someone is forcing them to make a record.
Right.
You know, the guys in Porcupine Tree were all a little bit different than that. You know, I was itching. I hadn't finished a record in a long time. I'd gone through my cycle of creativity and trashed a lot of things and gotten to where I was finally culling out of the stuff I was creating to come up with what I really wanted to share with people.
Right.
And so we all were. I mean, like Gavin right now, he's working on another 05 Rick record. Richard's working on another record.
With Steve Hogarth, I believe, of Marillion.
I think so, absolutely.
Oh,
and
cool.
Colin, you know, he's a little record factory. I think he just put out another one a couple days ago.
He did, yes.
So, you know, it's that stifling effect from the touring just led to this burst of creativity from everybody.
It's awesome. Well, I'm happy about it. I was so happy that you guys were here. You know, we got to see you. I got to see you twice, but you were in our general area three times within a year. I mean, that was fantastic, and I was so happy that you guys were doing this Coheed tour. I had this illusion in my brain, and maybe you could let me know if I was right or wrong, but I thought this is so great to be on this bill with this, you know, this hip, young, cool, modern, progressive rock band like Coheed and Cambria, where all their fans are like 12 years old, and they're going to get exposed to real live genuine Prague, you know. Did it work out that way, or am I totally delusional?
It did work out that way, but it was a fight every single show. They did not want us there. That fan base, they were not interested. We would walk out and they had a thing called the Black Something Club, and they got in early, so the first three or four people deep on the barriers at every gig were all Coheed fans.
Diehard.
Just a couple diehard Porcupine Tree fans that got in on our I can't remember the name of our club. But
yeah, right, I got you. Yeah.
Residents of a Blank Planet. And so you would walk out, and they would be turning their back on you.
Wow.
So that whole hour that we played, you were working to convince them that we were something that they needed to take a chance on and listen to.
Yeah. Did you alter the set at all? Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. We altered the set to play things that would appeal to that fan base, you know, and things that were a little more accessible, you know, and also we had a time constraint, which, to be truthful, was the big killer, or the big decider of the set list was the time constraint. There were just some pieces we couldn't do. Or if we did that piece, then we couldn't do, well,
of course,
three other songs, you know.
Yeah.
So a combination of the two, it was like, if you were a new fan who'd never heard of Porcupine Tree before, you know, what song might they want to hear? And that brought some of those songs into that set list.
Right.
That's so funny, really, you know, because I think Porcupine Tree fans, by contrast, have pretty open ears. And I think just because the nature of Porcupine Tree music is that it's so diverse and eclectic that I think when Porcupine Tree has a support act, the fans tend to be pretty
really good.
Inquisitive and curious to hear what they are. So it's quite a contrast then to go out in front of Coheed fans who maybe
turn
don't have
back.
That.
Yeah, I think that, you know what the answer to that is that Coheed fans are 15, 16, 17-year-old kids who feel really like, you know, they're disenfranchised. I don't know if that's the word I'm looking for, but you know what I mean? They feel
Well, they were very precious about the band and nothing could be as good as that, you know.
When we saw that show, what was that show at the Wiltern, right? Wasn't that, it was at the Wiltern here, When we were there, you know, Joe and I, you know, you guys were nice enough to give us passes. We went back and were able to say hello to you guys, which was really nice. And we walked back out to see Coheed. And I've seen Coheed many times, but their fans are like, Joe and I looked at each other, and it's like being at a Rush show. I mean, they're really just hardcore fans where the guys are almost in tears, you know, and the guys know more words than the girls. I love it. For me, I love the cult part of that thing, and I like the fact that can only grow. But the truth of the matter is, Porcupine Tree fans are older. They grew up on Crimson, Pink Floyd.
Yep.
They grew up on Rush and Metallica, even.
Yep.
And they're open-minded. These guys are just kids, and that's just sort of the way that goes. But they'll get there. They'll grow up, and they'll get there.
Yeah. Like, the producer that was just in the car with us is Chris Sheldon. And Chris Sheldon, you know, I mean, he mixed the color and the shape for the Foo Fighters.
Yeah, great.
And
record.
A bunch of other classic records. And, you know, he did the Oceanside stuff.
Oh, okay.
And Oceanside toured with us. And that was my first exposure to Oceanside.
Right.
But it was also a huge boost for Oceanside because they exposed themselves to this fan base that really warmed up to them, you know. And like you said, all these people that didn't know who they were gave them a chance. And night after night after night, would come off stage and go, God, that was fun.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's been that way for so many of our opening acts. They'd come off stage going, God, that was good.
Yeah.
You know?
Well,
our fan base is much more accessible.
Sure, yeah. You know, just open-minded. Like I said, I think when you come from that older, progressive background, you're really willing to listen to almost anything as long as it's not disco.
Yeah, absolutely.
Know, right.
You would, you know, something absolutely dreadful.
Right. You wouldn't put out a disco record, would you, Wes?
You never know these days. You know?
Are you a dancing queen? Like, are you a secret little dancing queen, Wes? Talk about that.
Queen maybe, dancing no.
Oh, boy.
Terrible dancer, you know. Just rotten dancer. But
if we took you to a redneck bar here in L.A. and got you hammered, could we get you to do a little dancing queen?
No, I'd fall over, actually.
All right, well, we'll make...
I'd fall over and roll around.
Wes. All right, I'm kind of in. That might be funny, too, actually.
You'll never get Wes to come down to the studio now.
I know, right?
I think you're going to take him out drinking at a redneck bar.
It's people like that. It's very entertaining to watch me fall over.
I'm in.
Let's take him out to drink.
Right. Oh, you're that guy, huh?
I am that guy.
That's funny. That's funny.
Mikey, he'll do it.
Right.
You know.
That's good.
It's always fun.
All right, Wes, man, what a treat. I really, I am pleased that you called. That was really good. Can't wait to hear the record.
Thank you for having me. I'm just really hoping that people will take a chance and try and experience someone else's experiences, so to speak.
Well, you know what we'll do then is I will go home and I will download it and I will pick a track.
Excellent.
And then we'll play a track here next week. Actually, you know what? If you want, I can. If you want to email me privately or email Steve and let me know if there's a specific track, then we can do that. We'll play that.
Honestly, with this record, I don't have anyone that they all are individuals within themselves, but with a collective theme.
Mm-hmm.
So anything you choose to play is going to deliver what I want people to hear. So
awesome. We've talked about how, you know, maybe how deep and dark perhaps some of the themes of the record are, but
sure,
there are some killer hooks and tunes. I mean, it's a very, very accessible record. I especially love the songs of Lust and Still Waiting. Huge choruses on those. And listeners, go check it out.
All right, johnwesley-hyphen.com, the Lilypad Suite.
johnwesley.com.
Did I screw that up?
Yeah, if you got to put the hyphen in between the John and the Wesley, you're just going to get the Methodist.
All right, so let's say it again, john-wesley.com.
That's it.
And go get the Lilypad Suite. It's brand new. And then you can buy all the other stuff, too, all the back catalog.
Download the whole back catalog for free and just enjoy it. Listen to the music.
That's awesome, man.
Fantastic.
Free is just really good.
Free's a good price.
Free is in everybody's budget, I'm guessing.
Yeah, and it's just, you know, it's like I said, it was killing me to not be able to have people hear that music. It was my life's work, and no one was hearing it because there were some gatekeepers holding it away from the people at $27 a disc. I'm like,
bastards.
That doesn't wash.
Yeah, I'm with you. All right, Wes, thanks, man. So glad to hear from you. So glad you're doing well, and hopefully you're going to be out here with this tour. I'm really excited about that.
Will do. And for all your East Coast fans, come see me up north. I'm coming soon. Two weeks.
Yeah. Well, there's tour dates on your site, I'm assuming, right?
Absolutely. Right on the front page.
There you go. All right, Wes. Talk to you soon, man.
Take care, Wes.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
Adios.
Well, that was a nice treat.
Fantastic. And, you know,
well done, Stephen.
You know, we shouldn't leave listeners with the impression that Porcupine Tree is now done. They're just simply on hiatus, and they'll be back in action 2012.
I think that's typical Porcupine Tree. I totally get what he meant by that. I mean, it makes, you know, when you think about it, and you step outside of the fan who wants more, you know. I mean, those guys were on tour forever and did a ton of shows. They released a DVD, right?
Correct, yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of material out there, so you can't ever miss that. But you're a Porcupine Tree fan, right, Rach? No.
Really got into Porcupine Tree.
Is that just because you just haven't gotten into it?
Oh.
Steven, where would you tell her to start on Porcupine Tree?
Rachel, you really need to hear In Absentia from about 2001, I think it was, and maybe Fear of a Blank Planet. Good entry points.
Really?
Fear of a Blank Planet. Fantastic.
I would go Deadwing.
Oh, Deadwing. Deadwing's great. Deadwing's even better, perhaps, than In Absentia. And then go for The Incident. I mean, you really can't go wrong. They're one of those bands that has such a rich back catalog, and they're essential.
Yeah, I agree. They're
essential listening. So, Rachel, we'll give you some homework.
You leave here, it's like going to school.
It's exciting.
How does that work with you, that we always end up giving you homework?
Well, but the homework is good.
Yeah.
Because whatever I've kind of gravitated towards, you know, like with Yes, whatever I grabbed and said, I can't deal with this, you know, it was obviously the wrong material. So you guys are, you know, knowledgeable on... You guys have in-depth knowledge about the, you know, these bands entirely, you know, the entire catalog. So,
but Rachel, you're a big Rush fan, right?
I'm a big Rush fan.
Ah, well, you know that Porcupine Tree's Fear of a Blank Planet has a fantastic guitar solo by Alex Lifeson.
Well, I guess I know where I'm starting.
how's that
for you? You can start on Fear of a Blank Planet. I'm telling you, start with Deadwing. start with that. That would be my. Or what do you think? You say In Absentia or Fear of a Blank Planet?
Yeah, you know, I think any of those records. I mean, a great way to do it is to start with In Absentia and listen to the progression to Deadwing and then to Fear of a Blank Planet and then to The Incident. And you can't go wrong with any of those records. Maybe start with In Absentia. It's a great entry point to the band's catalog. And then, of course, you can also work your way backwards to the variety of styles that Porcupine Tree were involved with before that. Right. More of a kind of a post-rock singer-songwriter kind of stuff.
We got to slow it down. Start with those three.
Start with that.
Yeah, we got.
We won't overwhelm, Rachel.
No, yeah, don't. No overwhelming. All right, so let me do a little reset here. Phone lines are open, 888-405-7440. You can hit us up on the email, usebinradio@usebin.com. I have a couple emails, which we will get to shortly. We are going to do the news a little bit later on, right, Rach?
Yes, definitely.
Good. So we'll do a little news. I have some stuff that I've been listening to, which I'm going to tell you about really quick, actually.
Yeah.
Because I listened to the new... They were streaming the new Soundgarden live album that...
Is it
called Somewhere on I-5 or something? I'm completely... Like, my notes are completely disheveled, and I got nervous
A bit like you,
when
right?
Wes called... Yes.
Disheveled.
That's the story of my life. Live on I-5 is the name of the record, mm-hmm. and it was really good. It's, you know, it's live Soundgarden. It's right at the prime of Soundgarden. I believe a lot of it's from the Bad Motorfinger Super Unknown tours.
Oh, okay.
Really good, and love all those tunes. And so I think that's out now. So I believe it was out either today or last week. It was streaming somewhere online, and it was just so good, man.
I gotta check that out.
It's power. That band was so powerful. Mm-hmm. Like they were so heavy in a very Sabbath kind of way.
Yeah.
They weren't heavy in a Metallica way or a Slayer way or anything like that, but heavy like in that stoner metal way, you know. And that's what, to be quite honest with you, growing up with Sabbath the way I did, you know, and growing up listening to that sort of thing, when I heard the Bad Motorfinger record, it just clicked for me, and I had to go back and listen to Loud Love after that. But it made perfect sense. Mm. Like, Kim Thayil is just so dirty and evil and fat on those records, and I love it. Like that deep sound to me was really great. So,
what do you think about the Soundgarden reunion? Because they're actually recording a record at the moment, and I think some of the tracks on it are going to be remakes of some of the older stuff.
You know, that doesn't interest me so much. I'm not a big fan of revisionist history like that. Mm-hmm. So there's got to be a really good reason, like somebody's dead.
did you get to see that reunion tour?
Well, they only did three shows.
It was Lollapalooza, right?
Yeah.
And,
Lollapalooza, and they did a show in Seattle and then a show in Chicago. Mm. Two club shows, and then Lollapalooza. You know, they're on their own. Those dudes march to the beat of a different drummer, so to speak. You know, and I think that drummer's in Pearl Jam, but that's another story. But you know, those guys do their own deal. So, believe me, I'll be first in line there. I would love to see that show, and I'm a Soundgarden fan, so I'm into it.
Fantastic! Yeah, looking forward to that. What else have you been listening to, Brad?
I listened to. I'm still on my Neil Morse kick from last week. Like, I haven't stopped for whatever reason. I know both of you guys weren't here last week, so I will tell you that I got sucked in to Neil Morse's Testimony record. Have you listened to that record, Stephen?
No, I haven't. No,
Rach? Are you? There you go. Share that thing.
No.
There you go. The Testimony record is the Born Again, How I Came to Be a Born Again Christian double album by Neil Morse. It is an unbelievably ridiculous, religious, Christian record. Having said all of that, because that's not my thing, musically, it's some of the best prog he's ever done in his life. It is unbelievable. It is so beautiful and sweeping and heavy and intricate and intense. It's just really, really great. Like, just the melodies and the harmony is so great. Another album that Portnoy played on, and I think Randy George played on that record as well, is really, really good. Problem with it is it's a double album, and there's only so much of that you can really take, you know. Like, it's a lot of like God music.
So it's like the Old Testament and the New Testament.
It's something like
that. It's very preachy.
From Genesis to Revelation.
Yeah, exactly right. It is super, super preachy. Like, starts out with, you know, it starts out with who he was before, and then hits you with how he is now, you know, and the process of becoming the born-again Christian. What's funny, Joe and I were making jokes about this last week. There's three or four overtures in this record. If that gives you any idea of, like, the starting, you know, the constant starting over stuff. Mm-hmm. But there was another record that he did, which I listened to, called Lifeline. Another, you know, hardcore Christian record. And again, you know, not my topic, not interested in that sort of thing. We have no music for whatever reason. It's so weird. Sometimes this thing just stops. And I don't know why that is. So let's just put that on.
Ah, there we go. There we go.
Weird how that works. Anyway, so I listened to the Lifeline record, and it's another, like, great album, and much shorter, like 5-6 songs, or probably 7 songs on this record. Two big pieces, one like 13 and a half minute piece, the opening track Lifeline. There's another 28 minute, you know, a little 28 minute ditty that he just sort of threw together and put on there. But in typical Neil Morse fashion, two big monster tracks and then a couple of great pop songs in there. And, you know, again, I have to separate myself from the preachiness because I get annoyed and aggravated. I don't want anyone telling me what to do or how I should be, and so I get bitter especially when it comes from that. However, musically, it's just transcendent. It's beautiful. Great stuff.
I gotta check that out. Matt Scannell of Vertical Horizon's been telling me how great Neil Morse's solo stuff is, and
it's tremendous.
So thanks for the recommendation.
Yeah, it's tremendous. And the other thing I listened to, which Joe and I started talking about last week, was I think we talked about it on the air, was U2's Unforgettable Fire.
Oh yeah.
Man, let me just tell you something. Joe had made me the bootleg of that tour from Montreal. And so I was listening to that, and then, of course, I had to put on the record. That record is, to put it nicely, retarded. That's how great that album is, and I cannot say it enough.
What does that mean?
It is so unbelievable. I mean, so fantastic. I think, in my opinion anyway, I think it's such a heavy emotional record, and that's another record with you know, serious religious overtones to it too, but it's not nearly as preachy, obviously.
Yeah.
But it is so, like, I mean, I think it's magnificent. And the guitar and the bass on, which is totally underrated, by the way, the bass playing on that record, is just, it's magical. Like, I get so sucked in. And, you know, certain records will take you to a place of, like, every time you hear it, you go to that place.
Yeah.
You just go right there, wherever that is, good, bad, or indifferent. You know, this, for me, obviously, takes me right into, you know what I mean, high school type stuff. Actually, earlier than high school, right? Because that record came out 84.
Yeah.
Okay, so I was 14 when that record came out, and I was a bloody mess, to be honest with you. But it takes me right to that place when I heard it the first time, and I was captured, you know, hypnotized by that record. And I just can't get away from it. So I put that record on, and I go right there. I love it.
You know, they re-released that album last year, a remastered version with some extra tracks. Have you checked that out?
No. Oh, yeah. You know, I haven't, but I know it's remastered, right?
It's remastered. There are also a couple of extra tracks, I think, at least one of which Bono had gone and done a vocal on,
mm-hmm.
That they hadn't quite finished at the time. And there's one track on there that you really want to check out called Disappearing Act. It's, mm-hmm. It's one of the bonus tracks. Magnificent. Great stuff.
You know, I haven't. Is the remastering good?
I don't actually have the album. I just downloaded I've got the old version of the album. I haven't.
Which is terrible sounding. Yeah. Sonically, it's awful. Mm-hmm. I mean, they really, that the sound on that record's awful, compressed, bad. Nothing is bright and shiny like that record should be, and rich. It's not that at all. And I'm hoping this remaster is more like that.
I'll probably pick up the remaster, but I did download the song "Disappearing Act" from iTunes. It's very good. So yeah, you want to check that out.
Rach, you too, fan?
Definitely. Yeah.
They should have a new album coming out this year, I think. They're working on something like three records, maybe May.
No use for the new U2.
Well, you know...
Really?
Did you like it, Rach?
The new U2, you know, it has legs to stand on.
Uh-huh.
But I prefer the old U2.
Right. For me, were you an Unforgettable Fire fan? Joshua Tree, Unforgettable Fire?
Yeah, absolutely.
Into it? Because you're more of a black metal, like... I mean, no, I know how much you like that stuff.
Well, you know, there's a time and a place for everything. And you too. I mean, it's you too. And,
right.
you know, Bono, he has such a soulful voice. He has so much emotion in his voice. How right. can you not love Bono?
Do they sort of supersede the, like, are they on that pedestal now? Is it like, well, you know, it's, you know, like...
Like The Cure, you gotta go see him because...
Do you feel like that about The Cure?
No.
Oh,
I'm saying about
good Lord.
The shows.
You made me nervous. Yes, exactly. Like, yeah. It's you too. I mean...
Like, I gotta go check it out because it's you too.
Yeah.
You know, at least once, you know?
They've been deified.
Yes.
Yeah.
But so, I don't think they're overrated by any means.
You too?
Yeah. Overrated,
good question.
Underrated.
Overrated or underrated? You too.
I think they're as they should be.
Okay. Steven?
Depends. Now, for me, I was never a big U2 fan in the 80s. Uh-huh. Now, I've gone back, and I love that stuff now. But at the time, I wasn't a huge fan. I think when they got really, really good was when they did Achtung Baby right through to Pop. And they did some
The stuff I hate.
Really interesting stuff. I think those are great records. Very experimental, off the wall, adventurous. And over the past decade, they've been a lot more conservative, a lot more like old U2. And I think sometimes they've been more concerned with just kind of maintaining their biggest band in the world status than really cutting loose. They've done some great songs in those past few records. But I thought that stretch in the 90s was very, very exciting. And I'd love to hear them go back to that.
It's funny. You know, I hated that part only because I thought what... Would they compensated for in electronics and experimental and change? Would they sacrificed melody and songwriting? And
true.
To me, U2 is big stadium melodies and anthems. And that's what I thought what got sacrificed in some of the Achtung Baby and all of that kind of stuff. Like, you know, Joe and I, when we were talking about this last week, we were saying that, you know, we don't need lemons on stage, those big lemons. We don't need these big, you know, Zoo TV type of stuff. For me, I need to hear that massive catalog sung in a stadium, and I need it, like, ringing throughout the, you know, throughout the stadium.
But think about that time, every man on the face of the earth wanted to be Bono. Wanted to look like Bono, wanted to be Bono.
Yep.
You know.
Yep.
But I think Bono... Yeah, you know, he's a very polarizing figure. His heart's in the right place. But I think with all the stuff he does, you know, shaking hands with heads of states around the world, a lot of people don't dig that. And it's difficult, I think, sometimes to separate the music from the guy. But, you know, I've seen the band live numerous times. They're always ridiculously good live. And they're on tour this summer. And worth checking out. You know, there won't be any lemons on stage.
No, thank God. There's just a big spaceship.
Apparently, you know, on that tour, on the Pop tour, at the Lemon, there was one show where the lemon malfunctioned and the band was stuck inside, which is very Spinal Tap. That would have been pretty hilarious to have seen.
That should have been on the DVD.
Yeah.
Well, that's very funny. Wow. Anyway, so I was on a big U2 kick. But you know what? I alluded to this earlier, and I'm debating. We are at the top of the second hour here, so let's do this. Let's go to a track, and then we will come back. We'll do the news. Right? You ready for the news?
Sure.
Okay. We'll do the news. I want to talk to you guys. I tell you, I saw the Lemmy movie finally. I finally, like, watched the whole documentary. So I have some thoughts that I want to share with you about that. The phone lines are open, which is 888-405-7440. We have some emails, so we've got a lot of stuff to do. But before we do that, I'm going to say that we should play some Peter Gabriel. How's that sound? Let's go...
And what are we going for in the Peter Gabriel back catalog, Brad?
You know, this is from Gabriel 3, and I can't look at the track right now. I'll tell you when we come back. How's that?
All right.
And here you go. It's no self-control.
Some sleep, I'm so nervous in the night, and I don't know how to stop. I don't know how to stop.
No Self-Control by Peter Gabriel, and this is the lovely smelling, halfway healthy metal warrior princess Rachel.
Barely healthy.
You're just barely there?
I don't think I'm halfway there yet.
Well, I'm sorry about that.
That's okay.
I'm glad you're here.
I'm glad to be here.
Yeah. I'm glad we missed you last week.
I missed you guys.
Joe and I had to do the news all by ourselves, and Joe and I look at each other and do the news. It's just, it's funny.
Did you reel the song?
No.
No?
How funny would that have been?
That'd be great.
That would be pretty funny if we sang to each other.
Yeah.
Not a bad idea.
Seriously.
Yeah. All right.
I say, if it ever happens again, I'm not here. Play the music.
That's right. All right. Fair enough.
Say it's Joe and Brad with the music news.
I got an email for you, by the way, in the break, which was, and I don't know who it was from, to be honest with you, but it was somebody said that you should really definitely start with Fear of a Blank Planet.
Oh, really?
Yes, as far as Porcupine Tree goes. So, yeah, there you go. I listen.
Kyle? Is that you, Kyle?
No, somebody from the UK.
Really?
Yeah, that's where the email address was. So
I'm going to add that to my list.
Okay. Yeah, I go Deadwing, but that's just me. I start with Deadwing, go In Absentia, and then The Incident, and then Fear of a Blank Planet. But, you know, I could probably shift either way on those two. So there you go. All right, Rach, what's happening in the news?
Well, there's a lot happening in the news. Excuse me.
Don't dine us, Rachel. Don't dine us, please.
No, she's no dying. No dying.
Beep. Beep.
That's like the beginning of Operation Mindcrime.
Beep.
I can't remember yesterday. I just remember doing what they told me.
Well, we were just kind of talking about this as I was leaving on our break. And so we'll talk about it now. Eddie Vedder is to release a solo album. It's out on May 30th. And the album will feature feature original songs and cover songs, but they're all going to be played on the ukulele.
What?
Yes. The ukulele.
I have no interest. That interest, that doesn't interest me in the slightest.
Now, that goes to the next question. Pearl Jam, Eddie Vedder, overrated, underrated?
Oh, for me...
Because I know you're a big fan.
Yeah, but are they overrated or underrated?
I would go with... I'm leaning towards overrated.
Why? You can't just throw it out there. You got to give... We need explanations.
I don't think... In my opinion, they're not the big rock star band they used to be. But however, they are kind of in that Bob Dylan category. That real kind of, I think, folk art. I hate to say it, but like an old man band kind of.
Pearl Jam?
Yeah.
Wow.
I mean...
Wow. You guys talk about this. We actually, Rach, I'm going to interrupt your news.
Yeah,
but
sure.
While you have this conversation, I need to do something.
You know, I think there used to be vastly overrated when they first came out. And I think now they're actually kind of a little bit underrated. The past two records that they've done are very, very good. Kind of a real return to form. And I think maybe they're a little bit underrated now. They haven't got the sort of press attention that they did back in the day. But that's my take on it. And they're reconvening for a new record at the moment, in fact. So tell us more about the ukulele record.
Ukulele record. Well, that's... I mean, you pretty much got it right there. There's...
Why? Seriously, what is the point of that?
Because he can.
I guess, but you know what? I'd rather listen to the Steve Martin bluegrass record than playing the banjo. Seriously.
Steve Martin is one of the world's best banjo players. I mean, that's a fact.
Right, but I'm not a huge banjo listening, bluegrass listening type of fan. But I would listen to that before I listen to Eddie. Well, probably not. I'll listen to the ukulele record once, I guess.
Steve Martin, he's amazing.
You're a fan?
Big fan.
Do you own the last record?
I love Steve Martin.
Comedy-wise or music-wise?
I'm talking both. I got so into Steve Martin, I wanted to go out and buy a banjo. I was looking around for a banjo.
Really?
Oh. Yes.
That's pretty heavy, right?
Have you ever seen Deliverance, Rachel?
Yeah.
Seriously.
That's really funny.
Your banjo fetish.
That's funny. All right, let me go to the phones really quick, and let's see who is in the used bin. Good evening.
Yeah, hi. I wanted to put in an order for a pepperoni pizza because I've been drinking blackthorn cider all night.
Oh, that voice sounds vaguely familiar. He used to show up here on Tuesday nights. Let me see if I can put that together. Is it Mike Portnoy? No, it's not Mike Portnoy. Is it Neil Moore? No, not Neil Moore. Is it Joe Mama?
Joe Mama is in the house.
What is up, my mother? What is up, dude?
How's it going, kids?
How are you, man?
Hey, you guys are doing great. You guys are doing great tonight. Sounds like a good show. It sounds like you guys are having a good time.
What time is it there?
A little after 4 o'clock in the morning, and we are rolling hard over here, boys and girls.
You've been awake for probably 20 some odd hours?
Oh, a couple of days.
Wow, that's impressive, mother.
We're having good times over here. Just to give you a little recap, we got in on Friday, and you know, like Crowded House says, we brought the weather with us.
Very good.
I heard you guys have been getting rain like crazy over in Los Angeles. We got the warmest day in London this year so far.
Wow.
We were driving around on the motorways with the top down, if you can imagine.
Wow, good for you. That's great.
Yeah, it's tremendous.
On the motorways topless? Sorry, say that again.
Steven wants to know if you guys were topless.
Yes. Okay. Indeed.
you can get deported for that kind of thing, you know?
Steven, you got to talk right there. You go.
You can get deported for that kind of thing, you know, Joe. That's they don't take too kindly upon those kind of things in England.
That's what they tell me.
So,
but it's been a great time. So we've hooked up with the Marillion camp.
Mm-hmm.
Right now we're actually in the north of England. We were in London for a couple of days,
right.
And really got the ball rolling there. But So, the real party started when we got to the north of England. We're staying right now at the house of where all the Marillion merchandise people are.
Wow!
And
nice.
So they're packing up all the stuff and getting ready for the trip we're going to make tomorrow.
Out
to Holland.
Can you get a brother man a shirt? I mean, come on! Don't.
I think we might be able to arrange something like that.
Really?
Can you get me an out of season DVD? Too much to ask.
I think we got one in the junk drawer. Maybe.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's great. So what's the plan, Joe? So when is actually the Holland portion of your trip?
Well, Holland starts tomorrow. We're heading out tomorrow night.
Okay.
And the merchandise team starts setting up on Thursday,
right,
and then the campers start arriving at the convention site on Friday morning, and then it all kicks off with four glorious days on the Udorp coast of Holland.
It's awesome,
and it's going to be big.
God, that is great.
Really funny. What?
Go ahead, Steve.
I was just going to quickly tell you, just a word of advice. Don't go topless in Holland either. I mean, unless you're in the red light district. If you're in the red light district, it's probably permissible. But, so there you go.
No promises, but keep your eye on YouTube. It's funny. In previous years, all the previous conventions, there's always been either out-and-out announcements about what Marillion's going to play, or at least a lot of fairly dead-on speculation about what the band is going to do at the convention.
Right.
They always, on the Friday night, the opening night of the convention, they always play one of their old albums in its entirety. Mm-hmm. In the past years, we've seen Brave and Afraid of Sunlight and This Strange Engine and Marbles. So we know that Friday night, the guys are going to do the entire Holidays in Eden album plus some bonus stuff.
Excellent.
But this time for the first time, the Saturday night and the Sunday night shows are genuinely shrouded in secrecy. We have no idea what's going on.
Wow.
The band isn't telling the crew, the merchandise people, management. Nobody knows what's going on.
Is there going to be a guy with a suitcase and dark glasses with handcuffs showing up on stage with the set list?
Anything is possible. Anything is possible. But yeah, shrouded in secrecy.
Awesome.
But we know that there's going to be some afternoon shows. Pete Trovis has got some kind of jam planned with the members from Fish's band.
Wow.
So, you know, anything could be going down here.
How exciting is that?
Yeah, it's very exciting. The whole crew of us were out at a local club in Wakefield in northern England last night.
Mm-hmm.
And there was this huge jam session with a lot of local performers. And the entire party came back here to the house, and we had this amazing sing-along jam session that went till about 5 o'clock in the morning last night.
That's great.
And so I'm firing on all pistons with very little sleep right now, but it's all good. I'll tell you what was really funny. We got everybody here in the room last night, and we got keyboards and guitars and everything going on, having this massive sing-along, and then I'm fielding requests, if you could believe it, from people from Mud Pie songs.
No, you're not. Come on.
Swear to you.
Wow.
So it was just a whole surreal situation going on here last night, but good fun.
That's really funny.
And So then, tomorrow we head out to Holland. So we're looking forward to a big time on the coast. It was great hearing from Wesley tonight. That was very cool.
I was bummed you weren't here. Actually, that was a total shock to me as well that he called in. Go ahead.
I have a feeling we could thank Steven for that.
Yeah,
right?
I was just going to say, I think somebody in the studio not named Rachel or Brad set that up, but I don't know for sure.
Very nice.
Yeah.
Very nice.
Well, that was good. Did you hear the whole time?
Yeah, absolutely. One thing he said that was really kind of interesting, and I've been hearing this a lot, particularly from Wesley, but also from Steve Wilson, and from a lot of really sort of audiophile musicians.
Yeah.
And I consider myself an audiophile, but I'm not opposed to the MP3 format.
Yeah.
And I know Wesley was talking about how you know, the higher quality FLAC is you know, sort of the preference for a lot of audiophiles. I don't know if you've had a chance, Brad, yet to see the Stephen Wilson Insurgentis DVD that I was telling you about.
No, I didn't get a chance to do it this week.
There's a scene in there that I really wanted to mention to you last week. I forgot to mention it, but Stephen Wilson at one point is on screen with Avi Geffen.
Right.
And Avi Geffen makes one of the funniest comments I've heard. He said, you know, it took somebody really special to get me known and get me out of Israel. So he calls Stephen Wilson his own personal Schindler.
That is really funny.
That's, yeah, absolutely. That's a good time.
That's very funny. Did you get all your West questions answered tonight by listening to Usbin Radio?
I think so. I'm looking forward to hearing that EP.
Yeah.
Anything from West is a good time. I like his back catalog. Yeah. I've seen him, you know, many times over the years because, as Stephen mentioned, you know, he obviously used to work with Marillion, toured with Marillion,
right.
And so I've seen him opening for Marillion many, many times.
Yeah, he said he's gonna. He said he's opening on the Montreal convention.
Right, he's doing the Montreal convention. We got some other acts doing the Holland convention, including some surprises. So, there's a singer songwriter who I've actually listened to a couple of her discs called Jo McCafferty, who's I want to say she's either Irish or Scottish,
mm-hmm.
And she's opened for Marillion a few times before. So we're looking forward to seeing her.
Right,
few other semi kind of prog-ish bands. So it should be a good time all around.
It's exciting.
But, you know, this time they've thrown some interesting twists on the convention this year as far as some additional events during the day, because they've always had sort of like the Marillion quiz and sort of, you know, just random events during the course of the afternoons to keep the momentum going, to keep the party going. As you know, whenever I get the chance, especially in foreign cities, I love to go for a long run in the morning, especially when I'm hungover. And so, topless, often. And so I did a couple of great runs around London the last couple of days. But this year, we're going to have the first ever Marillion 10K run early Saturday morning after the Friday night party. So that should prove to be a very interesting event.
Do you think there's any chance that you will not make that run?
No, I'll make that run.
Okay.
I'll make that run.
All right. Just checking.
I mean, that's a
rough go, dude. You will have been hitting it hard for close to 2 weeks at that point.
Yeah, pretty much.
Tell me, John.
There's also a Marillion Museum that they're setting up where they're bringing in all kinds of old props and stage gear and all kinds of memorabilia. So
beautiful.
That's going to be going on.
That's great. I love to hear that, man. That, to me, if I was going to see my favorite band at a convention like that, that's what I want to see, especially with such a rich history like Marillion, you know? That's what I want to see, is that kind of thing. That's great.
Yeah, there's no more fan-friendly band that I could think of than Marillion.
Yeah.
And a couple of quick Usbin exclusives that I can now give you the word on from the Marillion camp.
All right.
A couple of things. One, you remember last year they did some dates with Deep Purple around Europe, sort of a co-headlining deal.
Right.
They're going to be doing something similar later this year. They're going to be doing, I think, November and December, co-headlining around most of Europe with Saga. So that should prove to be an interesting double bill.
Cool.
I can also announce that it is official. We are getting a world tour in 2012, right after the new album comes out, which has not been recorded yet, but they're planning North America and an entire world tour to support the next one.
That is great.
Oh, man.
I think it was Kyle who called in earlier and said he's not going to get a chance to get to Montreal.
Right.
I have a feeling they'll be coming to Montreal in 2012, as well as the West Coast and a town near you.
Wow.
So make sure you check that out.
You just made my month there, Joe, because I can't. You know, I went to the past two conventions, the one in Holland and then Montreal, and I'm gutted that I can't get to this one. And I thought I'd have to wait till 2013 to see the band. If that is great news.
Yeah. Well, there will also, as they normally do, there will be a DVD. They'll be filming the convention. Mm-hmm. So DVDs at some point in the near future will be available.
Awesome.
1 year, just talking about how fan-friendly the guys are, 1 year what they did was they filmed the opening night, Friday night show. This was, I think, the 2003 or 2005 convention.
Right.
They filmed the opening night show when they played the Afraid of Sunlight album in its entirety.
Mm-hmm.
And at Sunday morning breakfast, when everybody was waking up from their hangovers, everybody's DVD was already ready, waiting for them with packaging and everything.
That's
so these
so
guys
great.
Are really on their game.
That's awesome. That's just perfect.
Yeah. And one other thing from the Marillion camp is, if you remember, over the last couple of years, Stephen Wilson and the Porcupine Tree guys hooked up with an indie label imprint called Snapper Records and started doing those 2 CD deluxe digipack re-releases of all the old Porcupine Tree records.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Sure, mm-hmm. Sure.
Marillion has now done the same thing, and we're going to start seeing deluxe repackaging of 10 of their more recent records, not the Fish era.
Uh-huh.
Those have all been remastered anyway, but the first batch are going to come out, I think, in the next month, and so we're going to see repackaging of Somewhere Else and a 2-disc deluxe version of Marbles.
Great.
And then they're going to start moving their way backward through the catalog for a while. So
there's a lot of
good stuff coming.
Can you get that not just a physical package, but will you be able to download that stuff?
Oh, yeah. Well, you could do that now. You could get all of that and find a better way of life at Marillion.com.
Is that right? I knew that I was missing something.
That's what I've heard. That's what they tell me.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this, Joe. Given that Marillion has a top secret set list for Friday night, for Saturday night and Sunday night, what are the greater chances? Is there a greater chance that they will A, play Grendel, or B, a cover version of Rebecca Black's Friday?
Well, those are both very intriguing propositions. I will say this. We were speaking with Lucy Jordash, the manager for Marillion,
mm-hmm.
And she's been threatening this for years, because for anybody that's not really a diehard Marillion fan, Grendel is an ancient 25-minute epic from, you know, their earliest incarnation, and song that they have not played since Steve Hogarth has been in the band, and have no intention to, but it's one of those iconic titles that the diehard fans still to this day yell out for during the quiet parts of the show.
Right.
And Lucy, I think, has just gotten so fed up that she said, you know, don't be surprised if we just have a tribute band come up 1 year and play Grendel before the band goes on stage.
Genius.
So, you know, the idea is out there.
Brilliant. That is that's a brilliant way to get around that.
Yeah,
and along those same lines, I guess it's worth mentioning the last couple of years that the convention has been in Holland. One of the extra bonus events, I guess, if you will, is they know that everybody sort of congregates in Amsterdam, starts arriving in Amsterdam on the Thursday before they make their way to the campsite on Friday. So every Thursday night before the convention begins, there's an English Marillion tribute band, mm-hmm. called Lords of the Backstage, and they stage a Thursday night fan gathering, and they get a couple of hundred of the Marillion diehards out there. And what they always do, and they'll be doing again this week, is they perform a 3-hour show at a local club in Amsterdam, and they call it All the Songs You're Not Going to Hear at the Convention. And
nice.
So they play all the obscure 1982 B-sides and, you know, all the real relics. So we're looking forward to that. That's usually a good night out.
I hope they play Tux On.
Yeah, that we've seen them do that, actually.
Nice.
So, yeah, a lot of good stuff planned over the next couple of days.
That is a big agenda of stuff.
Yeah, there's a lot going on.
Joe,
going on out here.
I got an email. I'm going to answer it with you on the phone. And the email is, what will you miss most about doing an evening of Used Bin Radio without Mama in the studio? And what will you miss the least?
Okay.
How do you feel about that?
I don't know. It depends on your answer.
Well, I'll tell you, I will answer...
I think I know what you're going to miss the least. I have not heard a single mention of Michael Bublé tonight. And I'm thinking you're feeling okay about that.
Yeah, well, that's as it should be. It should be like that every Tuesday night. Should be a Michael Bublé-free zone. But that's a horse of a different color now, isn't it? What do I miss? I'll tell you what I miss the most. I just miss talking to you, believe it or not. Like, not to get, you know, retarded and gooey, but yeah. It just got really warm in the studio, by the way.
Memories.
And
do you want a Kleenex, Brad? Just dab the tears away.
I do. I look forward to every Tuesday night coming and talking to you about, you know, whatever musical stuff is on my mind or whatever's on my mind. So I definitely miss that the most. And I miss you, you know, running around here working the board and being funny. So I miss that.
Yeah.
I miss the fact that you've got really bad gas almost every week.
Nice.
Okay, all right, that's not really...
Yeah, but Brad isn't wearing a gas mask tonight, which is a first.
And I'm not wearing underwear, which is an interesting thing in and of itself. But, you know, we'll talk about that later, just between us.
I've been powering through blackthorn cider and chicken vindaloo from a local Indian restaurant, so you can imagine what it smells like over here right now.
Why in God's name would you ever eat that Indian food? Jesus. I mean, for the love of Peter Jacobson, why would you ever do that to yourself?
Vindaloo is my pizza.
Oh, God. You know what my pizza is?
I think I'm going to get a t-shirt that says Vindaloo is my pizza.
You know what my pizza is?
Pizza.
Pizza! Damn right. Pepperoni, greasy, nasty, dirty pizza that makes you want to vomit after, and then you want to eat some more pizza.
Nice.
Yes.
Nice.
I'll tell you what I miss the most. I'm really trying to think. The Bublé thing is definitely one of them. I definitely don't miss the Bublé. There's really not much, actually, to be honest with you, that I miss. I don't really miss that much. There's not a lot that I miss. That's what I mean to say. I'm trying to think of even something clever and funny, but I don't even know that there is. How about that?
Fair enough.
Yeah. I'll tell you what I enjoyed,
hey,
though.
Brother man. Brother man, I got a question for you.
Okay.
And I've been dying to ask you this all day.
Oh, no.
So here it comes.
Here's the setup.
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Are you ready?
Bring it.
Are you sitting down?
Go.
What have you been listening to?
I missed that tonight. How about that? Did you hear I was listening to more Neil Morris?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
You like that testimony, don't you?
That testimony is really good, but have you listened to Lifeline? Have you heard that?
I don't have Lifeline.
It's really good.
You have to hook a brother up.
Yeah, it's, you know, it's more preachy, born-again stuff, but it's only like 7 songs, and there's like only 2 really long songs on it, so it's a little bit, it's easier to digest.
So prog.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what I was saying to Steven and Rachel. I said, you know, it's great because it opens up with this great 13-minute tune. And then he throws, you know, a little 28-minute ditty in there, too. But there's also, like, you know, a couple of 5 and 4-minute songs on there as well. So it's really good. Really, really good.
What you been listening to, Joe?
Well, yes. What have you been listening to?
I've been listening to pretty much exclusively a band called Jadis. I've mentioned them once or twice before.
Sure.
Really sort of under the radar, even in prog circles, but they're an English group. The guitarist from, you know, the band IQ. I know you're into IQ.
Sure.
The guitarist from IQ plays with Jadis now. And I'm going to have to turn you on to these guys a bit, because their first album and then their most recent album are just amazing records.
Right.
First record they did was called More Than Meets the Eye. There's a song called Wonderful World, which is epic. And their most recent album is called Photoplay, another just cover to cover, just a masterpiece.
Right.
Really, really digging these guys a lot. So
you have to bring that in.
And there's a Merlin connection there,
definitely.
Too.
Definitely.
Did you notice? I wanted to tell you something really quick before you tell me the next thing. The one thing that I miss the least? No, miss the most.
Okay.
I can't remember what I'm trying to say here. What do I miss the most? No, I miss the least. I got to actually pick featured tracks this week.
Yeah, well, good call on the Gabriel and the Metallica.
Yeah, I thought you would like that. I can't, you know, I'm not that bootleg guy. That's all you. So I had to do the best
I
could.
You know what? You know what though? That was a commendable effort, because that was not a readily available release.
Thank you.
So you went the extra mile. You got some rarities from '83, and me and everybody else listening totally dug it.
Good. Well, I'm glad. That was a dirty little show, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was good times. Good times.
Good times. Good times.
Joe, have you checked out that?
I wanted to hit you since we got a theme going. I wanted to hit you with an over under, and everybody in the room there.
Go.
Robert Plant solo career.
Great, great call. Rachel, you're first.
That's a mouthful.
Wow.
Overrated. Overrated.
Solo career overrated. Okay, Steven?
Underrated. But then, as many people know, Robert Plant is my all-time favorite, absolutely all-time favorite artist. And what a diverse set of records. The guy never stands still. Never gets boring. He's always exploring new stuff. And I tell you, if you haven't heard 1993's Fate of Nations or 2005's Mighty Rearranger, go check him out. Staggeringly good records.
Okay, agree, man.
I would say right on the money. How's that? And
wow, I know we got the full spectrum of answers here. Didn't
yes,
we?
The full Monty, my friend.
Fair enough.
I'll tell you why I say right on the money, and it's a simple answer actually. It's because I think he's very hit and miss for me. Some is really good, some is not great. I didn't love the Mighty Rearranger, but I really enjoyed Fate of Nations. So, and I think that the general thing out there about Robert Plant's solo career is it's hit and miss. Sometimes you get the good stuff, sometimes it's, you know, doesn't really nail it for you. So for me, I think he's right on the money.
That's fair. If I had to go, and I the reason I even brought it up is because, you know, there's been a lot of Zeppelin playing around the house today.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, I sort of oscillate on this one, whether he's overrated, right on the money, or underrated. Right now, I'm thinking overrated, and mm-hmm. the reason I say that is very similar to what you were saying about Radiohead earlier. I don't think I've ever read a review of a Robert Plant record where they didn't praise him for all the reasons that Steven just mentioned of being diverse and experimental. I've also, I don't think, ever read a review of a Robert Plant album where the Led Zeppelin name wasn't invoked at one point.
Right.
And it's like, you can't live on that forever. And not that, you know, not that there's anything wrong with Zeppelin.
Right.
But his catalog to me has been, like you said, sort of hit and miss. And while I love Principal Moments
mm-hmm.
and Pictures at 11 and Fate of Nations, some of the others just so spotty that I don't think his, 30 years of being solo now?
Right.
I don't think it's been supported by, you know, what he's put out. That's just me today, but I might change my mind tomorrow.
Well, for every Fate of Nations or Principle of Moments, you know, you get, what do you get in there? You get, a Mighty
Shaken
Not Stirred, right, yeah. Or you get a Mighty Rearranger, or you get a Honey Drippers record, something like that.
Right.
So I'm with you there. Yeah. I think it's, you know, it's funny, though. You know, I think there's a fear in, like, general, you know, big time rock magazines like, you know, Rolling Stone or maybe even Classic Rock or any of those magazines. They're afraid to say something bad about Robert Plant. But if you go into some of the other magazines, you know, they get a little ballsy and they'll get some young guy in there who'll actually tell you how he really feels. So I've read some reviews that'll say, you know, come on, really, dude, you know, maybe you should just do the Zeppelin tour. You know, but that's us.
Right.
Maybe that's two guys on Usbin Radio that say that.
Yeah, I think maybe. He's actually had a lot of bad reviews, in fact. Right into, you know, Raising Sand was kind of a game changer for him, I think. I don't think he had...
That was very polarizing. Raising Sand is a very polarizing record.
It is,
record.
But, it got tremendous reviews and sold a lot of records, and deservedly so. I think it's fantastic. But I think Mighty Rearranger, a lot of people didn't really... catch on to it, and man, that's a great record. I think that band, you know, they had such a unique sound with their sort of North African stuff and kind of Bristol trip hop and rock, and sort of and it was just a really unique sound. It's one of my favorite records of the past 10 years.
If Robert Plant did a record, Steven, of just him playing a kazoo for 45 minutes, would you buy that record?
Yes, of course. Okay. I mean, you know, I have.
Well, there you go. Now you put it. It's all in perspective now, isn't it?
I mean, I love the dude. He's my all-time favorite artist. He's up there with Marillion and Porcupine Tree and Gary Moore. So, you know, so I'm going to have rose-tinted glasses.
That's totally fair.
But I think that's what you do as a fan. If you really enjoy the stuff, and you know, it's not that he hasn't made some. You know, if you listen to Now and Zen, that record sounds very dated now. Shaken and Stirred. I actually love a couple of the tracks on this. Little by Little is my all-time favorite song.
Great song.
But that album certainly has its flaws. And so, yeah, you know, he's had his downs. But,
well, that was a good one, Joe. Do you want something from the Used Bin Junk Box?
Yeah, I'd like a copy of, I don't know.
Did you hear at the beginning of the show, I was ready to give something away, but I don't know what's in the junk box because you got the key. So I don't even know what I'm giving.
We still got lots of good stuff. So whatever people want, as long as it's on the website, which they could check out at usebin.com on the forum section.
Well done.
There's a list of what's in the junk drawer, and it's pretty much up to date.
Good. Good, good, good.
Can I do a quick over-under?
Sure.
The Strokes. Overrated, underrated?
Underrated.
Hold on, Joe. Rach, go.
I think they're underrated. I actually was just listening to their back catalog today.
Yeah.
And because they had a new album that just dropped today.
Mm-hmm.
Angles.
Just dropped. You're so hip. really hip.
But, you know, the Angles album is kind of flirting with, I feel like, more of like old school rock and roll, but an 80s new wave.
Okay.
But all their other albums are—they're very much a heavy rock and roll band, a classic rock and roll band. What you would think is rock and roll,
mm-hmm.
they are rock and roll.
Okay, fair enough. Joe, The Strokes, you go last because it was your call.
It's funny that you mentioned The Strokes. I'll just throw this out there. There are three bands that I always think of as sort of the modern rock bands that I don't get. Mm-hmm. And it's always been, well, in recent years, it's always been the White Stripes, the Strokes, and the Kings of Leon. And in the last couple of days, I've heard tracks from all three bands. And I got to say, Kings of Leon, I like even less than I did before. I've started to grow accustomed to the White Stripes for the first time ever in the last couple of days.
Good job.
And the Strokes, I heard it. I rocked for a couple of minutes, and then it was forgettable. And I thought, okay, they're right on the money. So there's sort of my take on it.
Good. Well, that's, when you were listening to the Kings of Leon, were you looking for pigeon shit anywhere?
I was looking for the door.
Yeah, I don't blame you. Or the gun. Either one.
Yeah.
For me, the Strokes, funny, I saw them on Saturday Night Live a couple weeks ago. I think they were on Saturday Night Live playing the new song. Didn't think it was very good. I didn't like it very much at all. I really liked the first Strokes record. It was good. It was very Cheap Trick to me, and I love Cheap Trick. And then for me, it gets old. Like, I think not far from what you said, Joe. It's sort of like I rock for a while and then I'm sort of done. And I thought,
yeah, it's not bad, but it doesn't stick.
Yeah,
I thought it's like wet pasta. The sauce is just not going to stick.
Yeah, I think that's right. The second record, which I think was Room on Fire, something. I think that's what it was called. I thought that was. It was good because it was a little bit different than the first record. But again, I can't hum a track and there's nothing that sticks out that makes me say, dude, you should put the Strokes on. You know what I mean? Like, let's listen to the Strokes for 40 minutes. I can't do that. So I would say that the Strokes are overrated because everybody was waiting for this record. And quite frankly, it just doesn't do much for me. Steven?
Okay, so I'm going to weigh in here, and I'm going to say that the Strokes got their name from all the hand jobs they gave to music critics over the years. I think they're just...
Did you get
insanely
one?
Insanely overrated.
Wait, did you get one?
Oh, my God. What do you take me for? I have integrity.
Well, I don't know. You're a critic. I just want to know...
I like chicks, man.
Well, so, you close your eyes. Okay, that's another show.
But you know what?
Wow.
This is a band
strokes.
That...
You could get Strokes from the Strokes.
How cool is that? What'd you do today? Right. Stroked out the Strokes? Okay, forget it.
You know, this is a band that, you know, music critics have almost credited with saving rock and roll over the past decade. And I just don't get it. I mean, you know, they're sort of like Cars Light, inoffensive, okay? But just hugely, hugely, hugely massively overrated. And that's my take.
Yeah, I agree. I agree.
Well, I don't think the Strokes are saving rock and roll, but I think that in their own small way, maybe Marillion are, because they're the most fan-friendly band out there. We're all excited about the convention. I'm going to give you the full recap next time we talk.
Can't wait.
And just on a personal note, I wanted to say just how retarded I am, because here I am thousands of miles away in a different time zone, and I heard my name on the radio, and I thought it was cool.
Well, it was. You're very missed in this room tonight. Let me tell you, as happy as I am to have Stephen and Rachel in here, you're still very missed. So there you go.
Hey, Joe.
Well, thank you very much. Yes.
I have a question for you. I have homework.
And I will have an answer for you.
Okay, well, I have a homework assignment, and that is to listen to Porcupine Tree. And yeah, we are trying to figure out what is the go-to album to start out.
Well, if Brad had just a slightly better grasp of his technology, which he's good, but not good enough.
There we go.
Then you would know that the email from the UK saying that you should definitely listen to Fear of a Blank Planet came from Joe Mama in the UK.
But here's the thing: is I figured that, except it didn't. I didn't realize that you were sending emails at 5 o'clock in the morning. I was been waiting for your phone call.
Yeah, but what is he going to send an email on or a text?
Well, they do have computers in the UK,
okay,
right? I know.
I forgot he uses computers.
Yeah. Yeah. No,
that's the other thing I want you guys to be excited about. Not only am I calling the show from a different time zone in a different country, but I'm calling on a cell phone.
Wow. Do you know feel like?
I got one finger in my ear. It's a totally alien concept to me.
It's awesome. welcome to the 21st century, my brother.
Wow. Right, Joe, the last person on the planet.
I don't want to cut this short, but I just want to say that I got to run because I've been listening to this great internet radio show that I want to get back to because I don't want to miss anything.
Well done, my friend. All right, pal. Well, we miss you. Have a great trip.
Talking to you all soon, and yes, have a great night.
Have a good trip, buddy.
Adios, muchachos.
Nice to talk to you.
And to talk to you? Nice.
Later, people.
Good night.
And now back to our regularly scheduled programming with Rachel in the news.
That's our mother for you, ladies and gentlemen. Well, that was fun. I love when the mother calls, huh?
He sounds different calling in rather than on the show.
Wait, because he hasn't slept in 3 days and he's hammered and he's got his finger in his ear and another mm-hmm. finger in somewhere else.
What?
Can I just say, I'm really surprised he hasn't slept, because I know that he went to watch a bit of football. Or
no, he didn't.
A bit of soccer. He didn't?
I don't believe so.
Oh, I thought he was going to go watch Manchester United. I thought they would have put him to sleep right away.
Yeah. you know what? I can't even do that because he's not here. It's no fun to make fun of whatever sport that is. All right. Well, there you have it. That was Mother checking in from Manchester, England. Manchester, England, England, across the Atlantic Sea. All right.
Ole, ole, ole.
Rach, you want to give us another couple news stories since we have some time?
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, so Anthrax guitarist Scott Ian has confirmed that he will not be participating in any of the Big Four shows scheduled from July 2nd to July 16th. Because his wife, now we use that term loosely, because it's not his actual wife.
Oh, it's not?
No, they're not actually married. They call each other husband and wife, but they're not, they didn't actually go through with it.
Why do they do that?
You know what? Keeping it spicy, maybe? I don't know.
How's that keeping it spicy? That's like, it should be the opposite. It's when you're married, you try to, you know, be the boyfriend, girlfriend.
Because
well,
maybe
wife.
Inside he's like, oh yeah, that's my girlfriend. It's not my wife.
I guess.
The old battle axe.
That's weird.
I think it's kinky. You know, he's like, I can leave at any time, but I don't want to.
Oh, I see.
But she's pregnant with their first child, and she's actually due at that time. And so they have Andreas Kisser from Sepultura to be. They'll be filling in for him. So will be filling in. For
right.
Him.
And we should mention that Scott Ian's wife is Pearl Adey, who we had on the show. And she is the daughter of Meatloaf.
Exactly.
Which is rad. That's rad. And by the way, Qasim Sultan played on Meatloaf's Bat Out of Hell. In case anybody forgot, I just wanted to make sure that you remembered. So he's not, that's, isn't he like, isn't like he Anthrax? So
he is basically, I mean, who wants to see it? Like Joey Belladonna? No.
Yeah, I mean, he's sort of the guy you go see, isn't it? Yeah, you
exactly.
go see Scott Ian, right?
When you think of Anthrax, that's the face you see. That's the goatee you see.
Or you think of a disease.
Well,
you know.
Or you think of death.
Right. Think
Terrorism.
Of Anthrax, you think of death, or you think of Scott Ian.
True.
Yeah. Well, that's a bummer for those people that are getting those shows. Fortunately for us, we're not. So I mean,
yes.
they're here in April. So
if you think about it, it's like Scott Ian's going to be missing. He's a big draw. You got Slayer, their guitar player. He's out indefinitely. They don't know when he's coming back because he has the flesh-eating bacteria virus.
It's like the old man tour.
It is.
It's like this is the big four of old men and gray hair kind of deal.
You know, it's funny because I interviewed Scott Ian about 3 years ago or so, and at that point they had a tribute band singer in the band, and the dude swore to me up and down that that was it. You know, they were going to keep the singer, and out he goes. And
we actually
comes
saw
Joey
them.
Belladonna.
We saw them with that singer, Dan something was his name, and we saw him open for Maiden on the Somewhere Back in Time tour, and it was. I've seen Anthrax a million times, and believe it, always. Because they're opening for somebody I want to see, not because I'm going to an Anthrax show. And it was horrific. It was embarrassingly bad. That's how awful it was. Embarrassingly bad. And the guy was uncomfortable, and he was really bad on that show.
Yeah, but I remember Scott Ian went on That Metal Show,
right.
And they were asking him, which singer do you prefer? And he said, Joey Belladonna just never fit in with the band.
Right.
And now now here he is.
Yeah.
Awkward.
Yeah, yeah.
Money will, pave over all sorts of band differences.
Yeah. So. I don't know. That whole thing is weird. He's been in and out of that band 3 times now. This is his 3rd time back in the band, I believe. So, whatever. You know, they're the first of that. They're the first on that bill, right? It's Anthrax, Megadeth, Slayer, Metallica. Isn't that how it goes?
Mm-hmm.
So, whatever. All right. So, enjoy your kid. I'm glad about that. I think Scott Ian's cool. I will say that. I think he's cool. I think he's good for metal. He's like, he's a character. He's fun.
How awesome is it, your grandfather, Meatloaf?
That's rad.
Awesome.
Yeah. That doesn't suck much. Although, he's on the Celebrity Apprentice this year, which is, weird that he's on that show.
Do you think it's weird?
He was on with David Cassidy, who just looked like such a bitch. I watched the first episode of that show, and David Cassidy got pushed around by Richard Hatch, the guy that the first winner of Survivor. And David Cassidy, he just looked so awful. Fucking head, like the worst facelift I've ever seen in my life. It looked like he had the facelift 3 weeks before they started filming the show.
Like Silly Putty?
Oh, he looked so bad and frail and skinny and short. And it just looked like... He looked useless. I actually wanted somebody to punch him just because he looked like such a wuss.
That wasn't David Cassidy. That was John Rivers.
Yeah, it might as well have been. I was embarrassed for David Cassidy, and I was really embarrassed for David Cassidy. But anyway, Meatloaf's on that show, which is
Did you catch Dancing with the Stars by any chance last night?
No. Did Jericho dance?
I saw. Yeah, Jericho dance.
How was that?
You know, it wasn't as terrible as I thought he would be. I thought he'd be kind of like tree stump legs.
Did he just engulf the dancer?
Yeah.
I mean, the guy's massive.
And you know, with a lot of the wrestlers, bodybuilders, there's not a lot of endurance.
Right.
You know, whereas you have Sugar Ray, and
right.
he's floating around, as you would expect.
Right.
I actually watched Kirstie Alley dance, and I was kind of glad I had a widescreen TV.
were glad?
Yeah, they had to, between her and Wendy Williams, they had to reinforce the stage. I don't know if you knew that or not.
How you doing?
Dude, does Wendy Williams' rack weigh about 80 pounds each tit?
Bazooka boobs.
It's not even like, there's so nothing attractive about her. Not
Aww.
A thing. I'm sorry, it's true. There's nothing attractive about her huge, gigantic fake torpedoes and that awful wig that she wears on her head. It's just, it's awful. And Kirstie Alley, who I always thought was really pretty, is just really fat still.
She's 60 years old.
Kirstie Alley
is 60 years old. For 60 years old, I don't think she looks that bad. 60.
No, cheers to that.
Cheers.
Well, she's no Bo Derek.
No Bo Derek.
But I think that's one of the reasons she went on the show is to lose weight. I mean, you watch those Dancing with the Stars guys, and all those guys, there's a ton of weight.
Yeah.
Except
for some of them, what's funny is I'm having this conversation about Dancing with the Stars. I never watch it.
Oh, really?
I hate it. I can't stand it. I can watch a lot of reality TV. and I can watch a lot of sports. Like competitive ballroom dancing does zero for me.
You know, when you have a good choreographer on the show, the dances are really enjoyable. But I haven't really seen good choreography since Julian Huff left, and her brother isn't there this year. And those two are the strongest, I think, dancers and choreographers that make it fun.
They're the pros.
They're the super pros.
Right.
This edition of the Dancing with the Stars, and I only saw the last dance last night. Apparently, it has Ralph Macchio of the Karate Kid.
Yeah, Ralph Macchio.
I'm just waiting for that dude to do the kick. You know, the crane kick. The crane. During one of the routines.
Yeah,
that's gonna kill, man.
Yeah, I apparently he was good. I don't know. Like I said, I don't watch it. I couldn't tell you if somebody was good or bad. I'm uncomfortable with the fact that Chris Jericho is there. It makes me uncomfortable. I want him to punch somebody just so that I could go, okay, cool, it's Jericho. Like, makes sense now, you know?
Maybe he'll do a Fozzy song.
That'd be great.
Yeah.
Yeah, not a fan of Dancing with the Stars. Idol, on the other hand.
Did you catch Idol last week?
I did, too. Although I still don't know who got kicked off yet because we haven't watched that one yet. But it was pretty good. I thought it was pretty good. They didn't sing great. Not everybody sang great.
Yeah, it was actually really disappointing.
And the thing is poor Tyler, like, he's just so bad on these live shows. He really is just so bad.
Now, see, I'm horrible with names. Which one is he?
What's that?
Which one is he? I'm horrible with names.
Steven Tyler.
Oh, Steven Tyler.
Yeah. He sings in this band called Aerosmith.
Oh, okay.
You may have heard of him. Yeah, so anyway, I think he's terrible. He says nothing interesting. But what's oddly enough is... Thank you for that, by the way, Steven. What's interesting, though, is that this Jimmy Iovine thing, which Joe and I didn't talk about last week, I'm so aggravated with him wearing those stupid headphones. And finally, last week, he didn't wear them, those Beats by Dre.
Yeah.
And I know he owns that company, like him and Dre are partners, and I get the promotion and all that.
Yeah.
But enough. Like, it gets to the point where you throw something down somebody's throat for so long, I start to throw up. And I'm done with those fucking Beats by Dre. So I was glad to see that he didn't wear those last week, because that really agitated me. But that and his team of producers, like between Rodney Jenkins and Don Was and God only knows, it's like those guys walking, they're like the misfit mafia, you know? They look silly and...
Tell us how you really feel, Brad.
Well, you know, look, man, I'm a fan of Idol. I watch that show, and I'm glad those producers are there, by the way. Just so you know, I mean, I'm happy that they're there. They deserve to be there, and they help those kids out.
So,
but it just looks silly. Yeah, it just looks silly.
Biggest disappointment of the night would be Smells Like Teen Spirit. I was expecting him to actually kind of do like a jazz fusion, something bluesy.
Well, he sang that song so bad.
So bad. And
terrible.
I mean, but you know what I noticed?
Mm.
I always knew that like Nirvana kind of ripped off the Pixies.
Mm.
I mean, not kind of, but, straight out, especially in that song. But I've never heard it so much as when he played it. I said, oh, it doesn't even sound like Nirvana. It actually sounds like the Pixies.
Yeah. I just, you know, there's something that they always talk about on that show, which is song choice.
Yeah.
It couldn't have been a worse song.
Oh, terrible.
Couldn't have been a worse choice of song.
I mean, and it was 1991, so just he had a lot to choose from.
Yeah, it was bad. What did the rock kids sing? And I can't remember. What did he sing? He did Wings the week before. He did McCartney the week before. I can't remember what he sang, but even he was just average.
You talk about the guy who looks like Fonzie Bear with a beard?
No. He's the one that did Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, which was just... It was terrible. Anyway, let's give us one more quick story, Rich.
Let's do that.
Yeah.
Well, this should be fun.
Uh-oh.
Motley Crue's Tommy Lee will star in a new reality TV series titled Culture Shock, which he sets out to uncover the practices and rituals of secret societies. And it's going to premiere on the Sci-Fi Network. Which right there is a mouthful.
What's the show again? What's the description of it?
He's going to go and he wants to uncover the practices and rituals of secret societies. So think of like the Freemasons. Can I infiltrate?
Right. Yeah, all right. Whatever. Why? Tommy Lee sounds so extremely qualified for a show like that. If there was anyone I was thinking of to do a show, Tommy Lee is the first one that comes to my mind.
Do you remember his, was it 2005, his Tommy Lee Goes Back to College? Goes to college.
Yeah, that went well.
Yeah, that went really
four episodes or something, right? whatever, it's a sci-fi channel. If 12 people watch, it's 11 more that watch that channel, you know, to begin with. So now that Battlestar Galactica is gone, that's a great show. The new Battlestar Galactica was great.
Great show.
No interest.
Great show. Yeah, I've got a news item.
Okay.
Sammy Hagar was kidnapped by aliens.
Yeah. I mean,
which
like,
explains so much, man. I suddenly get it. I understand why Hagar era sucked.
The Hagar era did not suck.
Yeah, he can't drive 55.
Yeah. Jesus, here we go. Look, the Hagar era was Van Halen. Just so you know, that's the Van Halen era that matters. But that's a horse of a different color. The Hagar thing.
No.
Yes.
Admitted if you were to go on a trapped on a desert island, you would not be bringing Hagar. So those aren't the years that matters.
Yeah.
That matter.
Whatever. I don't even want to talk about it. Now I'm pissed. You know, it's really true, Rach, to be honest with you. You're absolutely right. Because I would bring the first Van Halen records, the first of any of the Van Halen records I'd bring is one.
You gotta love, it's true. See, you got to love Dave for what he is. You might say he's a clown. He's a clown. But he's going to get the party started. He's going to get you going. He is Van Halen. You know, they are that party band.
Well, great. If I wanted to do that, I'd go to McDonald's.
Not Van Hagar.
No, that's a singer.
I'm actually with you, Brad. I think the Van Hagar era is very underrated, and he's a way better singer than David Lee Roth.
I'm going to look for
But back to this alien abduction. You know, Sammy Hagar gave an interview this week, which you can find all over the web, in which he claims he was abducted by aliens. And, you know, I think if you watch E.T. too many times while tripping on LSD, that's what happens. And, everyone's talking about the story, and this is, he claims that that aliens sort of went into his brain with some kind of Wi-Fi technology that they infiltrated his brain.
Yeah.
I don't know what to make of all that.
Hang on a minute.
Synthesizers.
That's Eddie. That's not singing. Forgive me, Father, but that's a singer. I have all right.
Nothing against Sammy Hagar.
Right. I have nothing to say about the abduction of aliens. It's just ridiculous. Okay, let me read you, Rachel. I have something for you. Where did it go? This is from Kyle. He says, Rachel, if you're a Tool fan, you need to hear In Absentia. And this is back to Porcupine Tree, by the way. He says, you need to hear In Absentia, and I agree with Brad, Dead Wing as well. Fear of a Blank Planet I'd hold off on. In fact, she'd be better to hear the nil recurring EP instead. Normal is better than the entire Fear of a Blank Planet album as a whole. Personally, my favorite has always been Lightbulb Sun, but the Tool or Rush even common qualities are more present in that stuff.
Thank you, Kyle.
I like nil recurring, especially the final track, What Happens Now, which is incredible, but. Better than Fear of a Blank Planet? Yeah, I don't think so.
Okay.
I don't think so. Anyway,
yes,
Rachel's got a lot of homework.
Right.
She's overwhelmed now.
All right. Gentlemen, ladies. Rachel, thank you for the news. I'm sorry it was abbreviated, but we got the call from the mother, and you know what you got to do when you get the mother call. You got to take it. Otherwise, you get a spanking, and you know how I feel about those. All right, so...
That's what Brad most misses about not having Joe here is the spanking.
Yes, that's another thing I miss. Let me give you quick some thank yous. How about that? And then we're going to wrap this fucker up. Rich, Pure Rock Radio, thank you very much. Terry Edwards and Max Krasny here at Westwood One. Rob Wilson and Chris Stone for usedbin.com. And make sure you go check out usedbin.com. Go to the forum, sign up, go and chat. Mother is in there all the time. Rachel is in there. Steven has been in there a few times. So you can go in there and do that. You can also find us on Facebook and give us a like on our page. And you can follow us on Twitter at usedbinradio. And Steven, thank you for being here, man. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me.
Absolutely.
Always fun.
And Rachel, thank you for being here.
Thanks for having me.
Rachel, we will see you next week. Is that right?
That's right.
Good night, everybody. See you next week. Same time, same channel. Yes, Steven?
You can say good night. Stay hot. Radio. Be cool.
That's right.
And chopping off.
All right. Good night, everybody. We'll see you next week.
What are you listening to?
quiet, numbskulls. I'm broadcasting.
You're listening to the live internet broadcast on Pure Rock Radio.
At PureRockRadio.net.